We should be live, at least on YouTube. Let me make sure we're live on Facebook in a second. Right. Well, welcome. Okay, yeah, we're good. Music Producer Conversations. And we are here with the great one, the Oracle. I needed like an intro. Sound Oracle from soundoracle.net. Hey, he got his t-shirt on, I just realized.
Hey, be different, be dope, man. You got to do it.
There it is. Awesome, man. Again, I appreciate you for joining because you don't have to. You have your own podcast, which is my favorite podcast, called Unquantized Podcast, which comes on every Friday, 4 p.m. on your
That's
Instagram.
right. Yeah, catch us tomorrow on Instagram at Sound Oracle, 4 p.m. East Coast time. But I love being in here, man, on when you do this on Mondays and Thursdays, because your audience is it's like such an inviting audience. You know what I mean? It's a
True.
warm family feel, so I love being here.
Speaking of invite, let's welcome some folks. Down One is here. What's up, Down One? Sherry is here. DJ Summit is here. Erlen is here. Eric made it back. Zykron, oh, you're not first today, Zykron. Sorry. Gabe, what's up? Vignesh, what's up? Lifestyle Beats, Young Chambers. Shout out to Young Chambers. Mestizo, Internet Shouty, Mr. Wigglestone. Oracle can't see the chat, so.
I
Mr.
don't know
Wiggle.
what's that.
Yeah, Ascending Keys, what's up? Soul T, I will subscribe back to whoever that subscribes to me. There you go. AJ, B Robbins. He said, yo, I got those cassette drums from B Robbins.
Hey, appreciate it, bro.
Yeah. CNC Music, what up? Oshin, Sound Slinger Studio. Carolina. Cool. Hoping that's another female in the mix. Welcome. Hamza, Jack Trippa, G Bass. So I apologize for being late today. I was on the road. I had to do a bunch of stuff. I had to pick up my car. Just one lesson I learned is never be in rush hour traffic. And that goes for business, that goes for life. Don't do what everybody else does at that the way they do it. Just like Oracle's shirt says, be different, be dope, lest you end up in traffic, like in business or in your daily life. Let me make sure we're good. I gotta share the stream real quick.
That's
But yeah.
actually a gem right there. You know, when I go on vacations a lot of times, the Tuesday after Memorial Day weekend,
Wait.
that's when I
Oh,
go
I'm sorry. What? Okay, you blew my mind right there. I wasn't ready for that. The Tuesday after the holiday. Okay.
Yep. Everybody's coming back on Monday. And it's funny, wherever you're going, you know, if I go somewhere nice, on the other side of the highway, it's just lines of frustration. And then it's me on the other side, just out of here.
So you know when you got it locked down, when you go against the traffic of everybody else. Like whenever I go to the store or anything, wouldn't let me share. Hold on one second, Oracle. Whenever I go to the store, I'm just looking at all the traffic on the other side as I zoom by on my in my lane. So that's how you have to operate.
Exactly. You see me at the grocery store at 6 o'clock in the morning on my Instagram feed all the time.
I'm
I
like,
don't have to wake up at 6 in the morning, but I know that's the best time.
Shout out to Carolina making that female presence known. What's that hashtag from the Oscars? It was like, it's like meet. What is it? Women up?
Me too.
Me too. That's right. Why are they getting women up? I don't know. But me too is like, oh wait, Jack Tripper. Sorry, I'm not giving you the feedback. Jack Tripper says I got that spacewalk. I think there was another shout out for one of your sound kits. You got the horns ready?
I thought I did. I don't. I don't. I
Oh
don't.
dang. Yeah, this isn't
Oh,
a.
here we go.
There it is, man. This is a lot of love for Sound Oracle sounds right now. Cassette drums, spacewalk, all at soundoracle.net. I gotta share this on YouTube. So, tell the people what's the latest with Sound Oracle.
So, man, the latest and greatest going on. I'll actually be doing a speaking engagement. If you're in Atlanta, I'll be speaking on March 28th and judging at Harlem Nights. Producer beat battle. Come out and check me. I don't know who subscribed to my mailing list, but if you are, yesterday you saw that beautiful video I put out of the seminar from LA, the good old BusyWorks Beats Mastermind Producer Seminar. Once again, bro, that was like one of the most amazing experiences ever. You know what I mean? So, looking forward to doing it again, bro. Looking forward to doing it again.
Wait, what's the beat battle called in Atlanta?
It's an iStandard beat battle. It's
Okay.
on March 28th at Harlem Nights.
March 28th. This March 28th.
Yep.
Okay, so can you make it to the
Yeah.
Okay,
It's
okay.
like two days before that.
Okay, awesome. Okay. Ooh, I was like, wait, can he make it?
Yeah, that's what I had to check on when I hit you back. It took me a while to hit you back. I had to check on that.
Yeah, see, the music producer community is growing in such a great way, and Oracle's definitely a relic in the community. So it's super fun to just even hang out with you. He has so much experience, so much knowledge. And this live stream was called, yeah, it'll be safe, Carolina. Or Carolina? Is it Carolina or Carolina? I feel like I'm saying it wrong. You got to correct me. This live stream is called The Low Cost Startup: How to Start a Business with Little to No Money. Because we've gone through it, we've taken nothing and we've turned it into something at very low cost. So,
Yes.
speaking of these events and all these extravagant things, what I realized recently was that events are very costly. So, it made me appreciate the low cost of starting a business online. So, we're not going to dig into all the secrets, but so you went, okay, March 28th, Gabe, yeah. Hold on one sec. I'm so weird. I got to be like a Trizza in this moment. I got to read you the chat. Okay. Okay.
Y'all are wizards with that. So I can't see the chat, but give it up for my man BusyWorks Beats doing all the multitasking. He's talking to the chat. He's talking to me. He's sitting here setting up the technicals. Man, span some hearts for that man. This is the
Spam some
hardest
hearts.
working man on the internet, hands down.
Me those likes on YouTube, that thumbs up. But shout out to the Music Producer Conversations. And again, it just shows how much the producer community is growing. You've done stuff with Producer Grind. You've done stuff with iStandard, because that's how I first met you in person, was the iStandard event out in Philly. Now, can you give people like an ex your words of how you would explain that experience from your point of view? Because I was in the crowd. You weren't in the crowd.
You know what? And it's different. It's different being on that side of it. Even though it's a beat battle, for me, it's like I feel like an A&R up there. You know what I mean? And it's just dope to see people come out. And then when you look at the crowd, it's just a hunger. Like you feel the hunger. It's like watching college ball versus professional ball sometimes. And man, it's just awesome to see people from all walks of life, and a lot of them, some of them just started, some of them been doing it for years, and everybody's just coming up, giving their best in the spirit of competition. So I mean, it's really awesome. Any producer meetup or any producer gathering in your city, near your city, I suggest you go there. Number one, you'll meet influencers, you'll meet people like me, you might meet people like BusyWorks Beats. Also, it's great to sharpen your networking skills, you know? Because one of the biggest things that we heard at the seminar was people were like, how do I connect with like-minded producers? How do I, build these relationships and these networks? That's one of the best ways to do it. Go to the places where producers are going to congregate. Everybody's on their A game. Everybody's ready to share. Those are the best times.
I agree. And these are the type of events, like especially the music producer mastermind meetings, where it's so curated that the only people who show up are the super dedicated ones. Like, again, these are people that are still talking about that event after it's been since when? We had it, what, January 28th? Like the end of January? And they're still talking about it, and they're still getting results from that seminar just because they took the time out of their day to invest in a moment, and then they have all these rewards coming their way just because they stepped out of that comfort zone. And the just to explain the difference between music producer mastermind meetings and maybe some other venues is that it's not necessarily a battle at the music producer mastermind meeting. The first one was more of a panel discussion where we had a Sound Oracle was up there all 4 days. We had Trizza come through from theproducerkit.com. We had Diego Ave. They just released a kit called the Ultimate Kit. We had Postman come through. Curtis King was there 2 days. We had Crucial Keys, Colin from E-Master, Louis King. So these people, they didn't even have to show up. They're just friends of mine who just decided to come by, But it was an experience share. It was like real world experience being shared in real time to you as a producer. And not only that, but we got to network and have fun. So it wasn't just like informational stuff. It was also connecting, and it made everybody feel real. People don't feel like a username when they're, when it's real life. So I encourage you to step outside the internet and meet people in real life, shake some hands, hug people, get to know people. That's where real relationships are built, in my opinion. Because all this greatness came after I met you in person. I mean,
That's true.
we were kind of collabing and doing our thing, but after I kind of met you in person, it was like a different, I could feel your energy a little bit more, you know?
That is true. And you touched on a great point. When it comes to relationships, like relationships are the thing, but what makes relationships worth it is the strength of the bond in the relationship and the value of the relationship. Just knowing somebody and you both having each other's information is not enough. But when you meet each other, you talk on a frequent basis, that's when the bond strengthens and that's when the real magic happens. So just because you go out and say you meet a Scott Storch or somebody and you get a phone number, that's not necessarily a relationship. You have to establish the relationship from there. That's just the connection.
Speaking of Scott Storch, Jay, I don't know if I'm leaking information. I might be leaking information. I'm sorry, but never mind. Well, it's public information. Scott Storch is coming out with a plugin called Storch, and I believe Jay is gonna be going out west. I'm just gonna leave it at that.
Oh,
So
dope.
let's just leave it at that. I don't know what I'm revealing. So let me shut up. But I'm excited for Jay. Junkie says, I want to grow up community. I want to grow a community, I guess, and be a part of the music industry. But can you help me to grow in the music industry? I guess that's his question, but he said it very weird. And shout out to Carolina. I meant to shout you out earlier.
Carolina. So is it Carolina, Carolina?
Yeah, she said she's from Brazil, I think. So they say it like the Spanish way.
I like that.
In
Okay.
America, we're like Carolina, you know?
Facts.
Carolina. Yeah. So I think.
But to the question, because that seemed to be, that's kind of a two-part question, even though those two things can intertwine. But to the first part, growing a community, two of the biggest keys to that, I guess they're the same thing, is transparency and authenticity. You know what I mean? You have to care about the people. And you have to solve a problem, you have to fill a void. That is the biggest way to start a community. And share. You know what I mean? Share. Encourage people to talk to you. Establish two-way communication. Don't just send people stuff and talk at them. Establish communications with people, and those people, under whatever you're communicating with them with, will start to communicate with each other. And you'll be the common bond. That's how we built the Unquantized Podcast community.
That's exactly what I was about to say. Your community, when I go in there, it's like everybody, it feels super glued. Like, that is the product. Yeah, super glued. It feels like everybody's super tight. They know each other. They know, they greet each other. It's like, I never understood. I mean, I get it to a degree, but like yours is like hardcore. Everybody knows each other.
It's amazing, right? They're collaborating with each other, they're working on projects together. Like, it's amazing, and it all stems from this podcast that's live on Instagram. It's crazy.
And let me give my input, how to go about the music industry. What I've noticed is that you got to have value to present, at least online. But at a certain point, it's relationships. Like, I can't even go to a certain studio without knowing the lead engineer to get into the studio. So if you plan on being in these environments, it's like invite only. Technically, you can rent it out and buy time and all that, but that's very costly. But even if you, sorry, open up an email by accident. Even if you buy the time, it doesn't mean you're gonna get the same experience. Okay, because so these little things are what separate people who are just kind of dabbling online trying to figure it out versus people who are making moves. Because you have a whole story how you met, you know, the chain of how you met Timbaland through Polo the Don, sorry, and then your story before that. Can you quickly go over that story so people who haven't heard it?
Yeah, sure. So I was living in Baltimore, had a studio, small hood studio, a mixtape type of studio, was selling beats. But the thing is, there wasn't really a music business there. The internet was kind of popping, but not really popping. So in the midst of everything kind of being at zero, somebody broke into the studio and stole all my equipment. So after that, a friend of mine, because I was pretty much fed up. A friend of mine said, "Yo, Atlanta's popping now. You should move to Atlanta." Brian Kidd was his name. And I was reluctant to go just because, being a creature of habit, you know, sometimes even though you're in a bad situation, for some reason, you're tied to that situation. You don't want to leave. So I entertained the thought. I told my girlfriend about it. She said she wanted to go as well. So we went to Atlanta with two cars, just some clothes. The plan was she was gonna get a job, I was gonna make it in music. It sounded crazy, but we got here And for the first time in my life, I felt determination. And what I did was I went to Studio Row, that's what I call it, on Northside Drive. And I would just go to every studio every day on a certain schedule. I had a schedule. I stuck to it. I got to know the people at the front door because I would show up every day and I wasn't going anywhere. So they would have to talk to me through the buzzer. After that, I built a relationship with them. The bond strengthened. I was able to then come into the studios. Mm-hmm. They would play my music because they liked it. For assistant engineers, I strengthened the bond with them. They would play it for engineers. And before long, word got around, and then Polo the Don wanted a meeting with me. That's how I met him. But it was the same process. When I met him, I played the music. He loved the music. He wanted to know about my sound design skills. And I started sound designing for him. We built a bond. He went to L.A. Mm-hmm. And I met Timbaland. I'll fast forward through that story. But I met Timbaland just in the midst of a conversation. I was telling a joke, and for some reason, they thought Tim should hear this joke. But anyway, Tim heard the results of what I was doing for Polo. Okay. And he called me and he was like, can you sound design for me? Can you work with me? Can you do whatever you're doing with Polo? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, sure. And I continue to this day to strengthen my bond with Tim. And I met, that's how I got cool with Justin Timberlake and all these other people. But it's from relationships. It's not merely just making the connection, but it's from actually building and strengthening the relationships. Mm.
And see, these are so, like the hidden things, because people only look at the surface. They look at soundroca.net and they think that if they just emulate what they see, then they'll get the same results. But they don't see what it actually takes to get to that place. They're only seeing the final, you know, the tip of the iceberg.
Right.
Or the tree above the ground, but it took all the roots below the ground to make the tree above the ground. Carolina has a good question. She says, did her message get lost? I might have highlighted the wrong message, but I think this is it. She says, we don't have anyone and we don't trust each other when we meet other females, because usually we use male names so one could be lying to the other. I think that wasn't the question, sorry. I highlighted the wrong thing. Her question was basically, as a female, here it is, the hard thing is being a female in the community and kind of don't have a place to run when it comes to talking with other producers, since they can either, they don't take you seriously or they hit on you and be rude, etc. That's from Carolina. So she thinks, how can she thrive in a producer community when all the guys are just trying to, they're not really worried about her music skills?
I'm reminded of something I would hear growing up. So if you grew up black, you often heard, you just have to work twice as hard as everybody else. Mm-hmm. Same thing. Mm-hmm. It's really the same thing. You have an added challenge. I do agree, but it's not impossible. And you can also establish your own organic community or your own organic reach via the internet. I'm really big on that.
Right.
You know, because the thing with the internet, it's such a numbers game, if you will, and there's so many people that you'll start to build with more like-minded people. And then you'll develop a tribe where those worries and those concerns don't really exist. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, you have to get out there and you have to at least attempt. And when doing it in person, just keep in mind that you do have an added challenge, but not everybody's a scumbag. Not everybody is, you know, you got to watch out and make sure you don't paint people with that brush until they prove that they are that person. You know what I mean? Because, you know, prejudice is a safety mechanism. You know, if you get bit by three dogs, when you see the fourth dog, you're going to be like, no, the dogs bite. So I get it. But just make sure you don't go into each relationship with that baggage.
Mm-hmm. And I think maybe the struggle, like the deep down struggle, comes from the fact that women aren't necessarily considered leaders, you know, through history. I'm not saying that they can't be leaders. I'm just saying, you know, when certain people think the Bible says that a woman can't be a preacher and that the woman should be the master of the home and not the whatever, you know, when people are coming out of that kind of era, it's hard to really establish yourself as a leader. And I think the producer is a leader role. We don't necessarily have to know how to play a bass guitar or an acoustic guitar, an electric guitar. Our job really in the studio is to make everybody, pull out the talents of everybody else, whether that's encouraging them to sing better or, you know, arranging things or our skills of mixing, whatever it may be. We're making these decisions as a leader. So I think the issue with females in the producer community is that guys have this male dominant role of trying to be the leader just because they're a guy. Not even the producer or artist type of, you know, conflict, but more so just because they're a guy. So again, it's kind of like the stigma against male nurses. You know, it's just like it's a gender role type of thing. I'm trying to think of another thing that guys wouldn't necessarily be. Maybe stewardesses. I guess girls used to be stewardesses.
Yeah, stewardesses. Male cheerleaders, that exists.
Male cheerleaders. Oh man, that's perfect. Yeah, you wouldn't necessarily see a male cheerleader. I mean, they do exist. But, you know, the guy's not going out of his way to become a male cheerleader. I mean, in most cases. So, I think it's up to you to break that historical stigma, Carolina. And again, it's going to be rough, but how would you say, Oracle, how do you sift through people's intentions when they come to you with an offer? Like, it could be any type of offer. How do you really sift through to know that they're being genuine? I think that's her ordeal. Like, how does she know people are trying to be genuine and not just, you know, try to do other stuff?
I don't have an exact formula, but I do know that time reveals everything. So don't make your total judgment based off of one conversation or one interaction. Have a few conversations, a few interactions, and they don't have to be in person. Mm-hmm. But after a while, you know, things will come to the surface. The person's true personality, to some degree, will come out. So just know that time is on your side, and it takes a while to establish connections. When you do meet somebody, regardless of how much they could add value to what you're doing, just give it that time. Because a lot of times people might meet somebody that's influential. They feel like they have exactly what they need. So the person will immediately just agree or just immediately try to establish a connection with a lot of people. And I used to do that. And then you realize after 3 months that you shouldn't even say hi to this person. You know what I mean? So just give everything time.
Interesting. Well, excuse me. I'd say a filter, just like, let's kind of use the dating world as an analogy. In the dating world, you wouldn't give guys the time of day if they didn't even want to take you out on a date, for one. And, you know, they have to have a certain look to them. I'm just saying, like, their sneakers have to be clean, or their teeth have to be, you know, they have to have good hygiene. You have standards for guys that you meet for dating purposes. But you need to also have standards for people you meet in the business world. It's the same thing. It's just a different context of energy. So what are your requirements for dealing with people in business? Is it that they have to have a certain reach? Do they have to have series turning on? Do they have to have a certain amount of, you know, revenue? What is your requirement for dealing with other businesses as far as collaborations? It's the same thing that goes for your filter for guys. You have a standard. You need to have a standard in business. And the better question is, we talked about this before, I think, are you even what you're trying to attract? Because you only attract what you are. Your screen's a little blurry. I don't know if that's my side. You just look like you're lagging a little bit. That's all.
Okay.
As long as you're good. Okay. Checking. So my point was, I lost my point. What was I saying again? I'm sorry.
You were talking about make sure that you are what you attract.
Yeah, you are what you attract. So Carolina can say that I don't understand why I attract these guys who are trying to do blah, blah, blah. But what do you bring to the table that makes you valuable to a producer who's about something? Like Sound Oracle, I'm just saying. Or even Busy Works Beats. Like, why would I want to work with you regardless? And I put that same standard to anybody in the chat. It's not saying I'm never going to work with anybody ever. It's just saying that we have to make business moves to grow. So if we're working backwards, you know, but are you what you're trying to attract to yourself? I think that's the better question.
That is true.
Demetrius has a good question. He says, I need to get in touch with female producers, but I don't know if there are any. He says, I don't know if there's a place where I should start looking. What do you think about that?
Instagram. I'm pretty sure, even though you're looking for some, I'm pretty sure you know at least two. Mm-hmm. And in the top, when you follow them, it's the drop down arrow that gives you three more people that are very similar to follow.
Oh, wow. That's clever. I didn't even think about
it. Air horn. I was going to give myself an air horn.
Got to do it manually. There it is. That's perfect. That's just like Amazon has those related products that pop up. after you buy something, it's like, oh, you might be interested in this book or whatever you're buying on Amazon. Mm-hmm. So that's super interesting. Here's a question from AG, the OG. He says he's requesting a tutorial about organizing your overall workflow, files, folders, presets. I really like this, whatever. So his question is, how do you organize your files or folders or just music production stuff? Do you have like a hierarchy system that you use?
I do. And I'll try to keep it short because I could really talk about this type of stuff all day.
Okay.
But it depends on what it is. Like, for instance, something that I have a whole lot of, which would be like samples, let's say, those are organized chronologically. You know, I'll have the year or the end of the year and the month and then the number of the folder from that month. So it would be 16 May '02. You know what I mean? So that's the way I organize my samples. And not only for the production, for the sake of production, rather, but it also gives me a snapshot of how I was feeling and what I was into at that particular point in my life. But the thing is, without going into the details of all types of production, just make sure the monotonous things that you do over and over again, you have favorite plugins, save them somewhere together. So you don't have to sift through 1,000 plugins. You have favorite sounds. Put those somewhere together. Mm-hmm. The more time that you can cut down, even though it might be mere seconds, 30 seconds here, a minute there, those things add up to hours, days, weeks, years. You know what I mean? So just anything that you do more than two or three times every time you're working, save it as a template or put it somewhere and name it something that your future self would look for and find.
That's perfect. Templates are extremely important. This is why I have a new respect for sound design. It's because I was describing in my live stream yesterday, like how to create any sound you want. But it took like 20 minutes to make a simple guitar sound. And I'm like, why would I waste 20 minutes of time trying to build a guitar sound when I can buy it from somebody for whatever the price is and probably hundreds of guitar sounds or whatever in FM8. So that's why I have a new... Once you learn sound design... sorry. You realize that it takes so much time that I'd rather purchase somebody else's experiments and ideas than try to sit there and program one by one all the time, because it eats up so much time, sound designing. And that's, I have a new respect for sound design. So like your kits and stuff, you want a go-to. And here's another part of the value of a drum kit is that everything is curated. So for example, if I want saturated hard, you know, hard drums, cassette drums, I know exactly where to go to. It's right there to get that sound. You know, if I want vocal chops, I used this in the other video for, what were we doing? I forget what we were doing, but I did like a vocal chop segment in the live stream and I went to your Articulate vocals because I needed a vocal to chop and make like vocal chops for EDM or whatever we were doing. So you need to, you know, the value of these kits is to curate. You can have 10,000 samples, but you're going to get lost. And, it, you know, curation becomes... the value after a while. Once you have a lot of stuff, it really becomes the value. My system, just I'm trying to read and talk and do all this stuff, but my system is for files and stuff is to do genre, is to do like a topic. So let's say you have a business folder or a music folder, whatever the big thing is, then you break music down into another thing called genre, then you break the bigger thing into a smaller thing. Okay, now we're talking about artists. Now you break the artist into albums, and now the albums into songs. So you go from macro to micro, and I've been using that system ever since for files and folders, and it works very well. And it helps your brain too. Dot K says I've met like 3 or 4 producers, follow a few on IG. I guess he's talking about females. I don't know. Do you know any female producers off the top of your head, Oracle?
Stony.
Shout out to Stony. She's in New York, right?
Yeah, that's my sister. Yeah.
There she is. Okay.
Yep. Young Stony. There's a young lady out here by the name of London Elixir. I meet her at a couple events. I've seen her around. She's cool. She's actually cool with one of the guys that does work for Unquantize.
Okay.
Yeah, there's Ashley Owens. She's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, so here's what I did. And Tiffany Miranda, I know her. But see, I'm also an ambassador of Girls Make Beats.
You are? I didn't know that.
Yeah, I'm an ambassador of them. And for those people that don't know what Girls Make Beats is, it's a program. I don't want to call it an after-school program, but it's a program that teaches preteen and teenage girls production and DJ skills. And anytime I come out with something, I always give it to them so they can use it in their training for the girls. So just doing something like that, I met a lot of female producers that way, or a lot of female producers knew about me. So that's just one way. You can find pockets of where like-minded people hang out, because at some point somebody else was looking for these people. And a lot of times people start groups based off of exactly what you were looking for. So don't only look for people, but look for groups as well.
Right. It's interesting because before, like a year or something ago, we started a campaign called hashtag Girls Make Beats 2. But I had no idea there was a Girls Makes Beats company. And I just started following her on Instagram. I don't know the owner's name or anything, but do you know the owner's name?
Tiffany Miranda.
Tiffany Miranda. Shout out to Tiffany Miranda. Yeah, I started following her on Instagram. And it's cool, like, to see what she's at the offices for Avid, you know, helping these girls out. And it's interesting because, again, she's trying to break that weird stigma that says that girls can't produce. I don't know what it is. Like, girls love making songs. They love singing. They love guitar. They love piano. But when it comes to making the beats or producing, what is it that, because everything else is kind of production except maybe drums or mixing or something. But why don't, and even mixing engineers, why don't you see a lot of girl mixing engineers?
I don't know. I think with programs like this popping up, there'll be more of them. Mm-hmm. But I talk to Stony about this all the time, and I'm not really sure. Mm-hmm. But the benefit to that is it's such a small group, and there's always like a demand of somebody's asking for somebody in that group. It's a great time to unite, and it's also a great time for somebody to spearhead that movement. Mm-hmm.
And shout out to people always in your stream. Umami, is she a producer?
That's right, Umami. How could I forget Umami Tsunami? Yep.
Don't Umami Tsunami.
Yeah.
And Ilicita, is that her name?
Ilicita too, yep. Ilicita. Exactly.
Those are the two that kind of stick out from your streams and stuff. So my point in doing the whole girls thing is that this is how you create, again, this stream is called The Low-Cost Startup, How to Start a Business with Little to No Money. You have to learn how to stand out so you don't have to spend a bunch of ad money or a bunch of energy trying to get your revenue up. And also you want to keep expenses really low when you're starting. So girls have the advantage, but they're not like using it. Like Wonder Girl, she's using it.
Yeah.
That's their like, what do we call it? USP. It's so rare to be a girl producer that being one automatically sets you away apart from the millions of producers around the world instantly.
I tell Stony all the time, I'm like, you're a unicorn.
A unicorn, right?
You realize you are a unicorn.
Send her the unicorn emoji. And I met some really, I mean, well, maybe a few, not a lot, but I met not in person either. But again, I think that's the new wave, female producers, because maybe we're breaking that stigma. But Daniel says, how can you sell your beats if you have no connection? So this goes back to what we were talking about, the, you know, having relationships, meeting people in person. And he's asking, you know, your general thoughts on how to sell beats if you have no context. Before you dig into it, I'm sorry. Think about The Sims. Even on The Sims, the game, do you know Sims?
Oh, yeah.
Even on The Sims, certain job elevation requirements require that you know a certain amount of people. So on Sims, you have to like have like an engineering skill. So you have to read a lot of books about engineering or whatever the skill bar is. So once your skill bar is up to 7 or whatever, you know, you're good for the next promotion. Sorry, my mind's going blank. And then the next promotion requires not only 7 points of engineering, but 5 contacts. And you have to like work hard to keep the relationships good. So it's the same thing in real life. What do you have to say though?
No, you're right. The way to sell beats, if you don't have any connections, that's a valid question. But I think the thing that needs to be looked at is you need to work on establishing some connections. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's like, I want to play basketball, but I don't have a basketball. I could shoot around with a rock. But I'm not really getting the experience of basketball. You see what I'm saying? You have to go out and you have to establish these connections. So you have two things that you really need to do. One is sell beats, the other is make connections. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And you can sell beats on things like, you know, whatever the sites are. I'm not really familiar with all the sites. Of course, there's a way to do that. Mm-hmm. But even then, you're just a name on a list of producers that are all doing the same thing. But the more people know, put it like this, to know more people, sometimes the easiest way is to get more people to know you. If you have a platform and you can reach multiple people, I don't care if you like, well, I don't have a lot of followers. You have something. If all those were physical people and you were in a room and you only had 50 followers, there were 50 people there to look at you and see what you had to say, that's still a lot of people to talk to. Like, for instance, the person that was asking, how do I find female producers? Put up a post, tag a dope female producer, or tag three dope female producers. You know what I mean? Don't underestimate your reach. Don't underestimate the value of your platforms. You should really try to grow those platforms and get as many people as you can. But sometimes it's just that easy.
It really is. And it's a simple mind shift. Once I shifted my mind and start dealing with relationships and building more important relationships, I've seen tremendous growth. Like Young Chambers asks, Oracle and Game, will I be able to shake your hands at the NYC meeting coming soon? Yes, that's the whole point. You know, and you're not only us, but you're going to be around producers who are of the same mindset, who are trying to figure out how to take all that energy and get to the next level. That those are the people you need to be around, not the people who are like still asleep right now, you know, who are going to wake up at 8 p.m. and make a beat just because they may or may not feel like it, with no traction in business at all. So those are not the people you want to surround yourself with. You want the people who are actively trying to figure out what's the next level, because that's what's going to get you to the next level. So, you know, we talked about connections. Yes, you'll be able to, I'll give you a hug, Young Chambers, when you come. And again, this event is not going to be for everybody. It's not going to be free tickets this time. It's going to be paid tickets, because we want to separate people who are serious from the people who are not serious. And the people who dabble and do all this stuff typically don't invest in anything, you know. And I'm not saying that people who don't have the money won't be able to go. It's not bashing those folks. It's that you'll be able to go when you're ready to go. But for the folks who are really dedicated and love investing in their business and love investing in relationships, this is what it's for. This is what our Music Producer Mastermind meeting in New York will all be about, as well as having fun. So that's coming soon, March 31st. I'm trying to lock it down, and it's a nice lounge right now. I want to lock it in, but I want to make sure we're good on, you know, people who are in the area. So it may or may not be at a high-end lounge called 48 Lounge in New York. It's very high-end. This is not like somebody's back room, you know, like somebody's cousin's shed. No, this is like a high-end place. So again, if you want to be around that energy to reach the next level, this is where you need to be. Again, that's March 31st. We'll have more details once it becomes available, but I'm working out the venue right now. So it should be at 48 Lounge. I just talked to Brian about it. So again, very exclusive place for very exclusive producers who want to reach the next level. So that's the Music Producer Mastermind meeting. Again, I got to read through all these comments. Somebody said, what's up?
I was going to say, this one is not for the hobbyists.
Yeah. Oh no, not for the hobbyist. Or if you're a hobbyist and you just want to see what it's about, hey. But it's gonna cost. Okay, the Raven says only in Baltimore. I guess this kind of relates to your story. He says, I'm trying to move out west someday. That's the goal. So your story was how you moved from Baltimore to Atlanta.
Yeah.
And did you just do that on a whim, or something forced you to leave?
I guess it was a mind shift. It was a culmination of events.
Okay.
You know, things were already at what I would consider a low. Then there was people stole all my stuff. And then there was the, hey, you should come to Atlanta conversation. So all those things happened at once. And that kind of led to it. But it was not me jumping up and having this epiphany one day and going. I was actually reluctant in doing it. And that's why I tell people, when I tell the story, I wasn't inspired, I was not motivated, but I was determined to change my circumstance.
Okay, so something did push you. It wasn't like, let me just go down to Atlanta. But you have to go through that. And that's why, you know, again, this is why the stream's called The Low-Cost Startup, How to Start a Business with Little to No Money. Because when you're making those decisions, there's no other option. You don't have $200,000 of a business loan to go invest. you're doing it from like nothingness. So would you say you invested in the beginning, would you say you invested your time, your energy, and your sweat equity to get...
You hit it right on the head. I was about to say sweat equity. That's what it was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it hit the ground running. It's not like I came to Atlanta and I'm like, let me figure out what I'm going to do. No, from day one, it's hit the ground running and make the plan as you go. I literally, I guess not literally, but I burned the boats pretty much. You know what I mean? And it was a sink or swim type of situation.
And it's funny you said burn the boat, because that's a military strategy, I think, by the either the Spartans or the Romans, one of those, or the Greeks, I forget which army. But they when they went to battle, they said, if we're going to go to the enemy's land, what we're going to do is burn the boat that we came over here in behind us, meaning there's no way to get home, so we have to win. And that victory mindset is what separates people from... dabbling from, you know, getting results. You have to put everything in this to get results. You can't kind of halfway, half step it. So did you go full in right away, or did you kind of half step your way in?
No, 100% in. But at the time, realize I'm with somebody who is now also depending on me to do something as well. So, you know, that was motivation within itself. But no, I was all in. And funny enough, I really couldn't get back because my car at the time probably couldn't have made it back. It barely made it to Atlanta. So I really couldn't get back anyway.
Mm-hmm. So literally couldn't go back. Jack Tripper says, I'm from Compton, now in Houston, was thinking of moving to Atlanta. Which do you think is best for me to do? Stay in Houston or go to Atlanta or go back to Los Angeles? I guess Compton.
Write it down. Pros and cons.
Mm-hmm.
What are the pros and what are the cons of each place? And then just really weigh out the facts. Don't go off of the feeling. Go off of what you actually, like what's there for you, what you'll actually do. You know what I mean? It's something to feel or guess your way through it. And it's another thing to write it down and really just weigh out the data.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So. This goes back to, I know we're kind of back in time with the chat, so I apologize, but I want to address people currently so you don't think I'm just avoiding you in the current chat. AG the OG said, what'd he say? Hold on, sorry. Oh man, darn, I lost your comment. Sorry, AG the OG. Where's it at? Whatever, I lost the comment. But it was about, I lost it. Never mind, sorry. But Carolina, again, we're going back in time. Carolina said, she's Latina and female, so she's effed, she said. I mean, I don't... Maybe people just don't understand the power of their own brand. I don't... Maybe that's why.
There we go. I think we're thinking the same thing. Like, nah, you're actually in a great position right now.
Mm-hmm.
There aren't a lot of you. Competition is virtually none.
Right. Oh, here's what AG, the OG, said. He said... something about dressing up. He said, like, dressing up at this event is going to be classier than the last event. What I'm going to say is, when you come to the 48 Lounge, come March 31st in New York, 2018, when you buy your ticket, I want you to flex on everybody. I don't care if that's a suit flex. I don't care if that's a Gucci from head to toe flex or Gucci flip-flops and just t-shirt flex. Whatever your style is, just... You know, just be vibrant that night. It's not business attire. I don't want to make it too businessy. Because last time it was business attire. But this time I want to make it a little more, you know, about the networking energy. The power of that network. Because I feel like last time we didn't get enough time to really network like we could have.
That's true. That's true.
Mm-hmm. So that's what I wanted to answer. AG, the OG. Something he just commented triggered that thought. Horizon says, what's the type of music that's going to be popular this year? What do you think?
More of the same. And it's not necessarily a bad thing, but a lot of the trap pop hybrid, top 40-ish now. You know what I mean? I don't see a full like change in music coming in this year. But I did a consultation the other day and somebody asked me a similar question.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was kind of related to when do you think music will change and why doesn't the radio play real music? I'm pretty sure you've heard that type of statement before.
Real music, yeah.
Yeah. And what I encourage people to realize is that you have technology on your side. Music today is more a la carte. You know what I mean? So, for instance, if you like boom bap hip hop, don't be mad that the radio doesn't play real hip hop or boom bap hip hop. You have playlists that are specially curated for your interests. So now you don't have to hear two boom bap songs and then a Brian McKnight song. You get everything you want straight off. So I think people should really embrace that more instead of complaining about the old school mass markets not having what they're looking for. People are creating stuff specifically for you every day. So don't overlook that. Mm-hmm.
And again, chat, we're a little bit behind, so we're answering questions as we see them. So if you're wondering if I see your question or not, I do see your live chat questions. It's just we're back in time answering them. So a little retroactive. I heard everything you said, though. That's yeah. And my input to that for the prediction, I guess, again, it's not going to change much. Nobody, we don't like change as a human race. We really don't like change very often. I'd say it's slowly kind of we're still in that Drake kind of what do they call it? Dance hall vibe. It's not necessarily dance hall, but you know what I mean? That kind of islandy sound. Because Tory Lanez even just put out an album and it has that sound still on it. Tyga just put out an album, still has the sound on it. So people are still trying to grip onto that wave. What's next? Again, that's a good question. A hybrid of trap. Because even, what did I see? Maroon 5, I think, collabed with like Ace Hoodie or something. Or what's the name? Ace Boogie?
A Boogie.
Let me look it on Google. Look it up on Google. I think it was Maroon 5 and A Boogie with the Hoodie. Yeah, the song's called Wait. I'm like, you would never have ever thought this collab would ever go down.
No.
Like, I mean,
look at that. Rappers are singing, singers are rapping. Everything is kind of becoming like this hybrid pop thing.
True.
Yeah.
And there, again, once it hits pop, once it hits the mainstream, usually it kind of, that's the peak. And then from that point, you got to look for the next thing. So I think people are looking for the next thing. Hold on, I'm just now seeing the Facebook comments too. Again, we're all over the place. Mike Wright says, when do you know when your beats are ready for sale? So how do you know a song's ready? I think it's his question.
Two ways that I can know off the top to test that. What do people say when you play your music? Not what do your friends say, but people that don't know you, that are hearing you for the first time. What is the general feedback? Not the stuff that you are pick, the good stuff that you pick out of what they're saying.
Yeah.
What's people's general energy? And you'll start to notice, you'll get a general vibe of how people feel about your music. And the other way is test. That's the thing. You'll never really know what you have unless you show it to people and you give it to people. And then the feedback is what lets you know if you really got it. And most importantly, what you need to do if you don't have it to get there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's... There's no, again, we're perfectionists, I think, as producers, because we know there's always a way to make something sound better or different. There's infinite ways, because creativity is infinite. Just like white noise is all the frequencies. We have all those options. So at a certain point, you just have to stop. And like Sound Oracle said, get feedback. Even Kanye, who put out his album, The Life of Pablo, he put it out, the song Wolves, remember that song?
Yeah.
And then they were like, the crowd was like, yo, you could have went ham on Wolves, but you kind of half baked it. And everybody gave him that feedback. And he literally changed the song on his album. He went back and changed his album. Never before has anybody gone back to edit an album until streaming occurred. Because before, once it was stamped, it was stamped.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, you could, I guess, redo it or whatever. But nobody ever really did it in that way. What do you think?
I think that's dope. But once again, that's a testament to the power of technology. In the age that we're in. Because like you said before, there would have been physical units and warehouses that you couldn't do anything about. But once you're streaming, you can change anything whenever you want to.
Mm-hmm. And that's the power, man. That's the beauty. I even noticed on Dr. Dre's album, Compton, I used to love his song. I forget the name of the song. I think it was Animals or something, but it sounded different. Like it was the one with, darn, man, I'm just going mind blank today. Let me look. Dr. Dre Compton album. Before I misspeak, it was the one with the girl singer, but I forget her name, Marsha Ambrosius.
Mm.
So it was either Genocide, it was either one of those, or Animals, or Satisfiction, that's the song. Or For the Love of Money, one of those. It's like they went back and re-recorded it, and it sounded way different. It didn't sound as good the second time. I don't know why they even redid it. But maybe I'm tricking myself. I don't know if they redid it or not.
Maybe. You know, people are perfectionists. People will go back. Mm-hmm. Like you said, people will change things that don't need to be changed. True. That's the thing. You know, one way, one tip for kind of not knowing when your beat is done, but at least having a way to know it's over. Mm-hmm. When you start certain things, have what I call a DOD, definition of done. So once I have X amount and this and that and the third, it's done. And then I move on. Otherwise, if you don't have an end goal, you could just sit and just keep adding on and adding on and adding on. Right. And the reason why people add on is from a fear that it's not good enough. Mm. So you'll never know it's good enough and you never get over your fear until you release it and let people hear it. So once you have that definition of done, it moves you to the next step to where you can get the real data. Because right now you're just in your head. Mm-hmm. What is it good? Is it not good? It's not up to you. It's music. You don't make music for yourself. You make music for other people.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. And I think with the technology, like you said, I have a different viewpoint, which is to throw it out. Even Facebook is not the same Facebook it was whenever Facebook started. It got update after update after update. You probably get updates for Facebook every single day. That's why I deleted my app. I was just like, I'm done with Facebook. It's just too much. They're already hypnotizing us with the notifications. But take this from the software companies. When they put out something, it's not perfect. Just like Xbox, when they first came out with Xbox 360, they had this thing called the Red Ring of Death. And if you're like, a bunch of people got these Red Rings of Death because the product wasn't perfect. So with music, we don't have that same mentality. But I don't want you to look at it like just your song. I want you to think of it as your brand. Once you take that song, that's just a piece of your brand, and you update your brand as you go. So that's how I like to look at it, rather than just look at a song like it's all you and that's it, and that's the only thing that people know of you, because it's not. So Case, again, we're way back in the chat. Case Suave, or Suave, sorry, says, I feel, now this is going to the sticking out thing. I feel like I got to work four times as hard because she says she's black, lesbian, and female. So she has a lot of things that people stigmatize her for, I guess. Again, is your brand bigger than what you just self-proclaimed yourself as? Like, I don't sit here, I know I'm black, but I don't sit here and like say I'm black, I have it hard. Like, I'm just like, I got to create my own way. I don't rely on another man to do anything. So let me get it for myself. And we're living testaments of what we're just saying. So you can self-identify with your restrictions, or you can use it as a way to be like, I'm unique. Because I'm looking at my skin like, I don't think I could live as a different tint. You know, I enjoy, I enjoy the benefits of my DNA. I love it.
That's true. I think I said something similar or one of our other shows. When you're in that situation, look out of windows. Don't look into mirrors. You know what I'm saying? Hmm. That self-reflective self-doubt, you just constantly looking at yourself and your restrictions, like you said. When you're focused on a goal or something that's bigger, you don't really have time to worry about those things. You're just worried about getting there. It's not about what you are on the way there. It's just about where you're going. As long as you're locked into that, those other things mean less and less to you.
Hmm. Deep. Again, I'm kind of going question by question, so these are kind of scattered. Demetrius says, what type of music do y'all produce? That's a quick question, but I have another comment I want to read.
Yeah. Cool. Hip-hop, pop. Track, really, whatever the project calls for, or however I'm feeling when I sit down. Mm-hmm. I don't really have a defined genre. I mean, you know, I work with people like Tim, mm-hmm. and Polo. Like, what type of music do they make? Just music. You know what I mean? It could be classified in different genres. Polo did a country song last year. You know, Tim does pop mm-hmm. songs and then trap songs. So mm-hmm. I'm really all over the place. It's just about good music, not so much the genre.
Mm-hmm. Mess around and drop a rock song on y'all.
Facts.
Yeah.
I did a rock song too for Christina Aguilera.
That's dope. Oh my goodness. That's dope. And I remember that being one of your things that you put out there as one of your credits. I didn't know it was a rock song.
Yeah. It was rock.
There it is. Ascending Keys says, what about mothers? I know we're kind of stuck on the female thing, but this was back when we were talking about girls in the industry. Mm. So I know I'm late on that comment, but what about mothers? Because I know the girl Amber L from Instagram that everybody just saw, and I made a video called If I Produce for Amber L, She was nice. That's why I did the video for If I Produce for Her, because I want people to know who she is. You know, give her a little shine, because she's a mother. And I was like, wow, you know, she's a mother. She's trying to pursue her dream. Give her a chance, you know. Yeah. And other things too, like contrast and whatnot.
Yeah, I mean, hey, mothers, same thing. It's an added obstacle, or it's an added, or it's added fuel for determination, however you want to look at it. Indeed. And it's a perfect example to a perfect time to lead by example. I don't know how old your child is or would be, but it's a great time to lead by example.
Mm-hmm. And didn't Moog come out with the Mother 32 synth?
Yep.
You think they called it Mother for fun, or do you think they're trying to interest mothers? What do you think?
I don't know if they said Mother in that instance, or if it's like the successor to another synth or something like that, and it's like the mother of whatever, you know. I don't know.
Is that what it is?
I have no idea.
Okay. Jack Tripper says, Pass Pace, sorry. Says, we need a female 808 Mafia. That'd be the next come up. Wouldn't that be fire?
That would be crazy, actually.
That'd be fire. Okay, I'm trying to read through all these comments again. Let me check out the current chat, because these questions are so old.
Is it Women's Day?
Today is Women's Day. What's it called? Me Too? What was the Oscar thing?
Me Too.
Me Hashtag Too? Me this too. Is a Me Too stream. But also, yeah. we're digging into how do you go about low cost without burning through a bunch of money in the beginning. You have to find ways to stand out. And we're giving you different ways to stand out. Not just your gender or your color, your skin, but, you know, a thought process of how to stand out. And this is the way we think. So you have to understand how to think about the way you stand out. Okay. If I sold a beat and it gets popular, how would I get percentage of that song? For example, Pierre Bourne gets 75% of Tekashi's 6ix9ine song Gummo. So I think he's asking, like, how do you negotiate, the back end, like when you do split sheets or something?
If you're an unknown producer and you're worried about that, those are things that you take care of in paperwork and documentation beforehand. Like, for instance, the person that is buying your beat, they should know that, you know, this is required. If it does this or you go this far, I'm required this, that, and the third. You definitely don't want to try to work that stuff out after something is popping. That's never going to work for you. You know what I mean? These are things that you have to take into account before you just jump out there and start selling things. Because a lot of times people confuse the beat making and the passionate thing that they're doing. It gets lost in the business. This is still a business. So if you were any other type of business, wouldn't you have that stuff documented for your clients and for your customers so they understand the proper procedures before they leave your store, and then something happens and now you have to find out where they live and chase them down and all that stuff? No, those are things that you take care of beforehand.
Yeah, always. I've just found out dealing with business partners and business friends, it's just, if you're going to do the paperwork thing, just do it first, because you don't want to be the guy who's like, okay, we start working off of friendship and trust, and then all of a sudden you want to introduce some paperwork. It just feels like you don't trust me anymore. Something's weird about it. Maybe legally you have to get paperwork done too. That's fine. But I'm talking about like an agreement type of thing where we're like working off of trust and we're just bouncing ideas back and forth. Now all of a sudden you want to write it into, you know, it just comes off a certain way. So, like you said, get it. If that's the theme of what you guys are going to be doing, just do that first to make the relationship go smoother. Not only like the business side, because that's going to have to go smooth anyway, but as far as like the emotional side, you know. So I forget the phrase, but one of the leaders I'm learning from said, show people your expectations right away, you know, and get them used to it. But here's, again, we're way back in time. But Carolina says, in Brazil, we don't have this problem internationals have. Brazilian women tend to be more dominant than foreign girls. She says, but like my business relates a lot more to an international style. So I guess, what would you say to the part where she said an international style versus everything seems international when you're on the internet? So
yeah, I would kind of like a definition of what she means by that. Yeah. Because, yeah, in my mind, like this, it's worldwide. You know, it's all worldwide.
This is a quick answer. Who's Tuning says, how do you sell beats as a beginner? I'm going to give you a quick answer. Okay. You have to learn how to run a business. It's not just, you know, if you want to get started, you got to find a commerce software of some sort, whether that's the beat selling websites like BeatStars or whatever the rest are, Airbit. I forget the other ones, to be honest. You can use their software to get started. But long term, you're going to have to learn how to run a business. And that's something I can't give you a 2-second answer to.
You know. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Selling beats is one thing. That's not really what you want to learn how to do. What you want to learn how to do, as Game said, is run a business and start up a business. Because you can have all the product in the world, but if you don't have a vehicle or a place to sell it or to tell people about it, you might as well not even have it.
Indeed. Sorry, again, my brain is in the chat, so I'm trying to think ahead while staying on course. Carolina says, I'll create the alpha female mafia, like the 808 mafia, the alpha female mafia. Go for
there
it.
There you go.
But another thing.
The seed is planted.
I'm sorry?
I said the seed is planted.
The seed is planted. And the reason I'm focusing so hard on Carolina is because, again, an underspoken part of our community is the females. It's like, because they don't feel comfortable enough to share, because there's so many guys that probably bash them down. Or tell them that they don't know what they're talking about. Nobody really, they don't have that platform or soapbox to kind of get their concerns out. So that's why I'm focusing so heavily on her, because we know what producers want. We live it every single day. So we know our concerns and we vibe off of what people tell us every single day, but we don't really hear from the females. But she said, now this ties into a bigger concept of perception. She said, that's tough to make a relationship with international people because okay, so what do you think about international? People who are like in Australia trying to work with somebody in New York. Do you think that's possible? And do you think they have to be physically working together?
No, you don't. you definitely don't. There's so many opportunities in so many ways now. You don't have to physically be in the same location. So working internationally with people, whether it's in music or any other thing, has never been easier.
Again, we're going to go quick through these questions. You want to do like a bullet round?
Let's do it.
Speed through these. Young Chamber says, does anyone have advice on how to find paying customers? Too many rappers want beats for free. I'll give my answer because... go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. Go on.
You got to put up some kind of barrier that filters out people that you don't want, because you're probably doing stuff that attracts people that you're saying you don't want. So you're doing something to attract these people. You have to find a way to make it so that there's a threshold that people have to surpass in order to make them more serious about your inquiries, you know, make them jump in another hurdle or two before you offer them anything about your beats. So you're probably not doing that. Just like girls, you can meet a girl right now on the street. That doesn't mean she's quality. That doesn't mean she's a good girl. You have to set your filters so that you know that she's really into you by passing those hurdles. What do you think?
Perfect. I think you killed it. It's just with the book crowd, we should leave that alone because you killed it.
Okay. All right. Curtis King's book is good. Shout out Curtis King. He's not here today, but shout out to Curtis King.
Yes, indeed.
Okay. So how to start a business with little to no money, says Commander. Do you have any hot kind of tips or ideas for those who...
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Your biggest ally, whether you're just starting or whether you've been in business for 20 years, your biggest ally is social proof. Social proof costs you nothing. You know what I mean? If you put out a quality product and enough people know about it and it inspires them so much that they want to tell their friends and they want to tell other people about it, that's better than any kind of ad you can put up. That's better than any type of copy that you could possibly write. Because the thing, no one trusts anybody else like they trust their family and friends.
That's so true. And the goal of marketing is to get word of mouth going. That's the goal of marketing. So if you can do that immediately, just off of associating with somebody like a Sound Oracle, I'm just saying, you know, or BusyWorks Beats, just being around us, taking pictures with us, that's social proof. So when you come to the Music Producer Mastermind meeting in New York and we're fancy, we got our... whatever on, you know, our flex gear on, and we're in this lounge, you know, 48 Lounge, the super high-end lounge in Manhattan, New York. We're going to do that March 31st. When you're with us, taking pictures with us, people have trust for us as a brand, Sound Oracle and BusyWorks Beats. So you basically get associated with the trust of us from other people. They're like, oh, he knows him? Oh, he must be whatever. Now, that doesn't mean we're like best friends just because we took a picture, but that's what everybody does. If you look in any restaurant, they have pictures of the celebrities that showed up in their restaurant. So true. It's the same exact thing. You got to learn to think on these levels if you want to expand. And we went over that in the Music Producer Mastermind meeting, but it's social proof. And Stony has a bunch of social proof on her website. Speaking of social proof, she has pictures with like everybody. Because I spoke to her about it. I thought that was fantastic. Yep. Oracle getting all... Somebody said Oracle getting all metaphysical right now.
Man, that's my mode, brother. That's my mode.
Okay, let me see. A lot of comments, but not a lot of questions. So I'm not like Trizzer where I go through one by one. That would drive me nuts. Do you have any books you recommend? Music theory? Okay. Do you have any books you recommend?
Music books or books in general?
Let's go general, because I think people think it's only music production books. And to me, you can't teach music production in a book. You have to hear it. Mm. You can't read about... How do you read about saturation or... Well, you can, technically. But how do you read about, like, groove? How do you read about that?
That's true. That's true. Unless you know how to read music, you're not going to hear it in your head. Let's see. Books off the top. The Subtle Art of Not Giving a F... Mark Manson. That is a great book. Ego is the Enemy by Ryan Holiday, also a great book. Work the System by Sam Carpenter, also a great book. I'm pretty sure some more will come to me, but those are the ones that that I've been liking off the top recently.
Interesting. So we're gonna have this documented so I can go back and get those. Somebody asked, how do you spell Stony? It's S-T-O-N-I. Music. I think it's Stony's World.
Her website, I believe, is Stony's World.
Mm-hmm. What's her like? And
her Instagram is Stony's Music.
Stony's Music. Okay, yeah. S-T-O-N-I. That's how you spell Stony. Carolina, yep. If you're wondering. Software is too expensive. Software is too expensive?
Yeah, I don't think software is too expensive.
Wait, here was his caveat. This is from Kush Crazy. He says, software is too expensive. You can always resell hardware, but you can't resell software. So I guess it's expensive because it's a flat fee and you never get it back.
Well, hardware depreciates, though.
You said depreciates or appreciates?
Depreciates.
Depreciates, yeah.
So you can resell it, but it's not like you're going to get what you got for it or more. And hardware is often not portable. As a matter of fact, there's a blog on my website, soundoracle.net. It's called Analog versus Digital. And we talk about this very same thing, the benefits, the pros and the cons to analog versus digital. One of the pros was reselling, but one of the obvious cons was no updates. You know what I mean? When stuff breaks down, you can't re-download it. You have to take it somewhere now to physically get it fixed. That costs more than buying multiple software programs a lot of times. So don't get caught up in the hardware thing. Software is definitely not too expensive when you break down what you really get it. Mm-hmm.
But I want to say there is a quality difference, in my opinion, from my
true.
Like the sound is like crystal clear. It doesn't sound like, to me, sometimes software can sound kind of plasticky. That's the only word I can think of to really describe.
Sterile is my word to describe it.
Sterile, yeah. Like, you know, so I don't want to go on that rant, but that's a very interesting topic. Xavier says, why is music not stressed enough in our education system? Seems like they didn't want us to learn about this art form. Sorry. What do you think about that?
Art in general kind of gets overlooked. Think about the things you learn in school. They're supposed to be skills for life. Well, people don't deem knowing music as a life skill. Mm-hmm. I happen to disagree with that. I mean, it's it's a lot about communication, and it teaches a skill that can't be taught by math or science or something like that. I think music is often important, and I honestly don't know why it's overlooked, whether it's special interest or no interest. But I think it's a shame that it's overlooked, because I remember having music class in school and I thought it was awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's maybe they cut back because the instrument cost or something cost too much. It's all about cost in these schools. But, and again, they taught music a certain way. So they taught it like the band. Like the only way to learn music in school usually is band or like choir class. You can't get an FL Studio class in your school. You know, right. Well, at least in the last time I went to school.
No, that's absolutely true. But I'm one of those people, if I can't get what I need in the place that I'm at, I'm going to get the closest thing to it. Mm-hmm. So if I can't get an FL class in my school, but they have a band class, I'm still going to go with the band class. I'm pretty sure I can learn something that I can apply to my FL life afterwards. You know, as long as it's music related and I'm staying in the neighborhood of it, that's what I really care about.
Well, speaking of instruments and learning, you know, we talked about the band thing. I wasn't a band guy. I just never liked it. I don't know why. But 808 Beats says, what instrument do you recommend learning for producers? Because there used to be this stigma that said that producers had to know multiple instruments like trumpet, saxophone, or guitar. You know, they had to learn a piano. They had to know those to be a producer. So what do you think about being a musician versus being a producer?
If you had to pick one or a first one, I'd definitely say piano. Because in the music that we produce, mm-hmm. if you could play the piano, you can play a MIDI controller, you have access to VSTs that can sound like any instrument. Pretty much. So I would say piano.
That's the key. That's the secret. You know, the piano, again, is a MIDI controller as well. So you can play these samplers like Kontakt or whatever it may be. And you can play a saxophone on your keyboard. Mm-hmm. But there's a difference. You know, there's a difference in sound and little nuances and all that. But still, you get close enough. And if you ever get to that point, you can always hire out a session musician. If it gets to that point where somebody actually needs a live saxophone. Yep. So, you know. But Oracle said the answer I was going to say. There's the incredible Largo. Do you know who that is? Who mixed Timbaland and Danger sounds for decades.
Oh, yeah. Marcy Largo is female engineer. She mixes a lot of people's stuff. She mixed a lot of Polo stuff, and she's incredible.
Hmm. Yeah, we're still on the female wave. Okay, so I didn't even know. I wasn't familiar. I'm not familiar with everybody in the industry, I'll be honest. So hold on. A lot of comments about being the unicorn in production camp. Do they have production camps where, like, you know how, like, they have band camp?
I don't know.
Do we need
to? I've never heard of that before.
Do we need to throw a production camp? That'd be dope.
I'm thinking we do.
Wow. A production retreat up in, like, you know, the woods somewhere.
You know how crazy that would be? That would be dope.
That'd be wild. These comments are all over the place. Somebody said Wonder Girl is one of the famous female producers, but she is never in the spotlight. Why is that? Says Who's Tuning. She's never in the spotlight? I mean, maybe recently. I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you keep up with her? I don't really follow her like that. I know she's familiar with the brand, but I don't follow her every move.
I don't. I mean, she gets probably the most recognition out of any female producer currently. I wouldn't say that she's not in the spotlight. And if that is the perception that she isn't in the spotlight, I don't know why. I wouldn't necessarily think that it's someone keeping her out of the spotlight, if that's the, you know, kind of where it's going towards. I don't think that that's going on.
Because you mentioned that before. You're like, people aren't worried about I think it was your podcast. You're like, nobody's trying to, like, hold you back. If anything, they're trying to make money with you or something. I forget the way you said it. Or Trizza might have said it that way, but... What do you think about people trying to...
I do remember talking about that. Once again, growing up, you hear these things as a child. Mm-hmm. My mother, my grandmother, whenever these shoes look stupid, I would always say, ain't nobody looking at you. Which, you know, it's just something that mothers and people say. But as you get older, you kind of become self-consumed and you do think that people have the time and the energy just to hold you down. Mm-hmm. People have so much going on in life, especially people higher up. They're not wasting their time to keep you back or to keep you from getting in. Mm-hmm. They don't even know that you're at the door. Mm. So, you know, and that's just for people that want to post their next post about my haters and all that stuff.
My haters?
It's not really anybody out there hating on you. They don't even know that you're here. That's the problem. People may not pay you the attention you feel you deserve, but that is not hate. That is merely you on your part not making enough noise. So now you know what you need to do.
I'm sorry. Getting all these notifications from weird thing. Your last point, I'm sorry, because I got distracted by a notification. You were saying that, what was the concept? I'm sorry.
Yeah, the concept was no one really has the time or the energy, especially
hold you back. True. And there's different types of leaders. You know, so in short, I'm going to say this. A leader who tries to hold you down is also going down with you. In order to hold you down, he has to push you down, which means he's going down. And a leader that lets you grow, you know, elevates with you, he also goes up with you. Imagine holding hands with somebody who's in a hot air balloon. You're going to go up with them unless you let go. Okay, so a lot of people who are holding people back are going down anyway. So you're not going to see much growth with them regardless. Capri says, how much are tickets for the Music Producer Mastermind meeting in New York, March 31st, 2018? How much are tickets? I'm going to start the tickets at $147. I only want serious, serious producers to show up. Everybody else who wants freebie tickets, sorry, this is just not the event. Again, it's going to be in a high upscale lounge called 48 Lounge in Manhattan, New York. So it's like dead center New York. We're going to have Oracle there. Is Trizza coming?
Yeah, Trizza's coming. He's never been in New York either, so I'm going to make sure he's there.
Yeah, Trizza coming. And we're just going to share and be open, give you complete honesty. And give you tactics to really take your business from where it is to the next level. Again, you want to be surrounded by people who are trying to get to the next level. You're probably surrounding yourself with people who don't care about their results. And you got to get around these folks. This is the only way to do it. Get around the people who are serious. And we're going to curate that for you so you get around the people who are serious. People who aren't serious aren't going to invest $150 in a ticket to go downtown New York on a Saturday night. They're going to stay at home because they're scared of they don't really have any business being in business. So you don't want to be around those people. You want to be around people who are dedicated and willing to invest. So Capri, tickets going to start at $150. We'll have VIP tickets as well. You get to play your music in the club environment. That's going to be cool too. Instead of like a speaker, like JBL speakers or whatever, we're going to have it in the club environment. So you hear your mix in the actual place where people are going to hear it as an end result. So if your mix doesn't translate, you'll be like, why isn't my mix translating? You know, do you need to go back and check the mono mix? So we're going to do all that type of stuff as well. Have VIP tickets as well. And again, it's going to be food, drinks. It's going to be luxury. We're going to a high-end lounge. It's called 48 Lounge in Manhattan, New York. So I want you to dress in your flex clothes, I want you to show up, you know, nicely. This is going to be a lot of fun. And again, you get to spend time around us and pick our brains for 4 hours. So it's going to be from 6 to 10. On that Saturday, March 31st. All right. And again, we're working out the details on the venue, but it's most likely going to be at 48 Lounge. Okay. Young Chambers says March 31st for the meeting is perfect. I want to see you there, Young Chambers.
Yes, sir.
How much are tickets again? $150. Jack Tripper says, any producers here from Houston? Oh, sorry. I thought that was a question. Somebody says, how do you feel about Bandcamp? I've been wanting to make music since I was really young. When I had a first look at one of the earliest versions of FL. So I guess this same question could go for like SoundCloud.
I don't have much of an opinion on those. I've never sold beats online or anything like that. So
yeah, Bandcamp, I'm out. All these like built for you things like Reverb Nation, Bandcamp, just be everywhere. I think that was one of your points to somebody. Yeah.
It was in that video I put out in my stories today.
That was really?
Yeah, from the seminar, the mastermind meeting from LA. And right. The guy was asking, you know, how do I connect with certain people? What should I do? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, the answer is everything. Like you said, be everywhere. Because mm-hmm. sometimes you put yourself in a box by trying to pick the right answer. And you might not necessarily have picked the right answer. You just picked one answer. And that might not have been the best for you. You have to get out there and know what doesn't work for you, know what does work for you, and concentrate your efforts in the areas that are working.
True. And a lot of people want that certified answer. It's always going to change. The market changes every single day. That's why we watch something at night or in the morning called the news. It's because there's something new about our world. And it's always going to change. So there's never one way to do anything. That's why having multiple perspectives, Oracle's perspective from his years and years of experience and hardships, he brings you that reality of music production from ground zero all the way up to having sounds and records on the top albums ever made in life. So that's insane. And, you know, to be around Trizza, who's super dedicated to getting to that next level. I mean, he went from being an online music producer. He didn't like it. He transferred into doing stuff offline, DJing, running his own company at producerkit.com, theproducerkit.com, sorry. And you get to see his journey from transitioning from the online to the offline space. My journey, you get to see me. Okay, I had a laptop and a dream, literally, in my mom's extra bedroom during the heat of the summer, the height of the summer. It was super hot. I had a burning hot laptop on my lap. I remember sweating. I remember like it probably burning lines in my thighs and just being like, I need to change my life. Like, I can't sit here and have this stuff in me but not get it out there. I felt trapped. And I learned how to take nothingness and turn it into something. And now we're working with excellent brands. I mean, the top of the line brands, Universal Audio, Razor Music, Image Line, Waves, Isotope, Arturia. Who else?
Ableton on this side. Ableton.
Yeah.
Native.
Yeah. Triss is like, no propeller head, but.
No propeller head for him. But yeah, just like you said, and that's funny, just going from that one moment of having that dream or that one moment of determination, and then now working with these major companies and being around these major people. Mm-hmm. All it takes is a mindset shift.
Exactly. And we're going to show you exactly how to do it from our perspectives. That's why you have to be in New York March 31st for the Music Producer Mastermind meeting. Again, we're going to be at 48 Lounge. And Amir Kat says, I live in VA, but I will drive to New York.
Hey, that's dope. You know, I used to drive from VA to New York every weekend for like a year, 2 years. So that drive ain't too bad. Look forward to seeing you there, bro.
There it is. And we want people from the different areas, not just New York. Of course, everybody doesn't live in New York because New York is super expensive to live there. Like, the rent is insane. So we understand you're coming from different states like Connecticut, Virginia, you know, Georgia even. Sound Oracle's coming from Georgia, Atlanta. And we want to see you again. It's going to be at 48 Lounge, March 31st, and it's going to be ticketed. And the tickets start at $150. This is not for the dabblers. This is for people who are serious, for people who want to network, for people who want to grow in business. We're going to share everything from the ground up. So, and it's a four-hour event. So from 6 to 10 on Saturday, March 31st at 48 Lounge.
I'm prepared to give 4 hours worth of gems.
Yeah. It's going to be fun, and it's going to be fun. We get to celebrate and learn and share. What better place to be on March 31st? You know? Somebody says, Sound Oracle speaking facts, says Xavier. Because facts. We need, you know, whenever you say facts, somebody needs to hit that emoji with the fax machine.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I'm trying to read through these. Sweat equity goes a long way. Yes.
Yeah, sometimes beginning, that's all you have.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, this is a question about the event. Ice Mike, again, I'm way back in time. Ice Mike says, is there a particular hotel that you're looking at close to the event in New York? Is there a particular hotel that you're looking at close? I guess, where am I going to stay? Is that what you're asking me?
Sounds like he got the hotel plug.
You got the hotel plug, Ice Mike? Can we get discounted rates?
Facts.
Yeah, it's going to be a one-day event, so you don't need to stay in New York. It's going to be on a Saturday, so you can just come and leave. You don't have to stay in New York. But if you want to stay in New York, I mean, there's plenty of hotels in New York. There's endless hotels. Make sure they don't have cockroaches in their bathrooms, like mine. Don't go to the Penn Hotel. Sorry.
Hey, if you need a lower price, you can always go over the bridge a little bit to Jersey. Mm-hmm. You know, still be close by, but maybe get a better price on a hotel.
And Uber your way over.
There you go.
Somebody said he's in Rochester, New York. Shout out to you.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, we're way back. Somebody said we don't need no boats. So that was back when we were talking about.
Oh, man.
That's how far back we are in the chat. Let me check the modern chat because I feel like I don't want people to feel neglected. B. Robbins put the fax machine icon up. emoji. that's literally going to be the thing now. Any age limit? Good question, Blabby Flame. No, there's not going to be an age limit since it's a private event. There's no age limit. But in order to drink, obviously, there's security and all this stuff. So there's a staff there. It's not some janky place. This is like a high-end lounge in New York. Super luxurious. It's in Manhattan. Again, it's called 48 Lounge. So if you want to look up the address, there's no age limit to come. I meant to clear that up. Sorry. But in order to drink, obviously, you have to show ID and that you're 21 and everything to the people at the bar. Okay. And it's going to be fully staffed too. There's going to be food too. How do you format music into a CD or an external media? What? Wow. A CD. Would you ever print your own CDs?
Back in 2004, maybe 2005 or six, something like that. Yeah. Yeah, there are a ton of tutorials out there on YouTube on how to do that. I'm just wondering the reasoning for one to do that.
Yeah. What would you suggest, like, somebody who has to pass out music in the, like, if they're physically out on the streets, what would you give somebody if you would give them anything?
I would give them a flash drive or a card where they could go log in somewhere and get something to hear my music and also receive something of value just for coming there and listening to my music.
I'm glad you added the other point because it's like, chances are people don't care about your product. You know, you have to give them a reason to care. And that's the second part of what you just said. Give them something worth them going to your website. Yeah. My mom was like, do you have business cards? I hate when people ask me, do I have business cards? Not my mom, but I mean, anybody else. They're like, do you have business cards? I'm like, do you understand that my website is my business card?
Right.
Yeah.
So when we were out in LA doing the mastermind meeting, that was the first time in years I actually had cards on me. My wife, she's like, "Hey, I got this for you." Like, she made me some like super dope business cards.
Oh yeah.
But on my business cards, there's no phone number. Like, no, don't call me. It's my website and my email address.
Right.
you know what I mean? Like, no, go there. It's 2018.
Mm-hmm. So at least you had something that with that data on it. This is just funny from Xavier. He says, I spoke about the dress code. He says, I'm wearing my Versace button down with my Gucci loafers and FTP bucket hat with my Louis belt. What's FTP? Do you know? Paragon?
Hey,
I don't know.
I don't know. To me, it can stand for the people. I don't know. But all I know is he's going to be fresh.
Yeah. Ernest says, when are you going to sell the video from the mastermind in LA? We're waiting on the video to come back from an engineer who's working on the audio because the volume was in and out, I guess, on the mics. So he had to level it out. So I'm still waiting on that. I started a blog. So I'm going back. I'm going forward in time. Then we'll go back in time. Chauncey says, I started a blog. What steps should I take before posting my music on there? On a blog.
I guess it depends on what your blog is about.
Right.
You know what I mean? Develop your audience. Number one. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he went that far or if he's at that step, but it takes more than just making a blog. You know what I mean? It's not if you build it, they will come. So right. I would say concentrate on building an audience. And it goes back to what we were talking about earlier. Mm-hmm. Offer people something of value. Don't just ask them for something like, hey, listen to my music. Give people a reason to want to check out your blog.
Mm-hmm.
And you could even offer to guest blog for other blogs, you know what mm-hmm. I mean, to kind of spread your reach.
True. Like Oracle said, what is your blog about? Like, is it just you posting the link for your music? You got to wrap whatever you want people to kind of get used to around. Like Curtis Kitt said, you have medicine for people that is probably going to make their day better, but you have to wrap it in a brownie. So like a lot of artists might, like Eminem, didn't he put out like singles that he hated, but he had to do it in order to get popular? So that people could really listen to Eminem.
Yeah.
It's the same thing goes with your blog. You have to figure out a way to make your music appealing but by adding more value around it. Would you agree?
Yeah. I do. It's peanut butter. You got a dog, right?
Yeah.
That's how you give your dog medicine. You put it in peanut butter. Your blog has to be peanut butter. If you give a dog anything in peanut butter, he's not only gonna love the peanut butter, he's gonna love whatever's in it. That's what your blog has to be. Peanut butter.
That's the one reason my dog is insanely in love with my mom. She associated the love of peanut butter with her smartly. Yep. I was like, that's genius, but I didn't think to do it that way.
I'm yeah, like, from wow. a puppy. About yeah, I was all about the peanut butter.
You can say your perspective on this, but Nick Sanchez says, so I have no clue where I start when it comes to selling beats. What would you recommend I do? First of all, there's two different paths, I would say, like the internet thing and the offline thing. Is that like a clear, or would you say that that's not really a thing anymore?
The offline thing? No, it still is a thing.
No, I mean like the difference between the two.
Now that you bring it up, no, I don't think there is much of a difference. There are advantages to being in person. Well, there are advantages to being on the internet too. In person, you establish more of a connection over the internet. It's a wider reach instantly.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, he doesn't know where to start.
Right. Pick a pen.
Research, number one.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of people that sell beats. I'm not saying do what everybody else does, but you can learn a lot from other people's experiences and mistakes before you just dive headfirst into something.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you hit that research stage yet, but just research. Look at some people's strategies, some people's methodologies, some people's reviews of how their thing went when they were on certain platforms. Mm-hmm. Once you do that research, like I said, once again, you can compare the data and that'll tell you what you need to do.
Mm-hmm. And my kind of quick answer is, choose if you want to go online or offline. The offline journey is a little bit more difficult but rewarding because it's built on relationships, but also getting in these studios offline or getting people to your home studio offline, you're still going to need an online presence of some sort to attract these people offline. And as far as selling your product, your beats, you have to have some form of commerce. You have you have to have some form of marketing. And again, if you want the secrets of this stuff, like how we built businesses from nothing online, you got to meet us in person, Nick. So you got to come out to the Music Producer Mastermind meeting. Our next one's going to be in New York at the 48 Lounge, March 31st. And it will be $150 to start for tickets. And only the dedicated are showing up. That's all we want there is the dedicated. So if you want your answers, you got to be there. Turkis says, is it hard to become a successful producer nowadays? So I guess I don't know what success is to you. Maybe I guess a Metro Boomin nowadays.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I was like, give me some standard for success.
Yeah.
Is it hard? Put like this, it's simple, but it's not easy. The steps to do it are quite simple, and you could almost Google the blueprint, but actually executing it, that's the part that's not easy.
Good point. And you said this at the seminar, you were like, it's simple, but it's not easy. And that's so true. Like there's probably three steps to this whole process, but doing it, executing it, and knowing how to execute it well and making sure that this leads to this, which gives you the ultimate result. That's the key, but that's not easy. It's always changing for one, and you got to be up on the strategies. What do you think about Frank Dunes? I've never heard of Frank Dunes.
Frank Dunes or Frank Dukes?
I think maybe he got auto-corrected. Maybe that's what it was. He says, what do you think about producers like Frank Dukes?
Dope.
Mm-hmm. I've heard the name, but I haven't I've heard the name. I don't know much about him.
He does sample packs. They're not royalty-free ones.
Oh, those. Okay.
Yeah, but dope.
The, what are they called? The
Kingsway.
Yeah, Kingsway Library. Okay, I've heard. Okay, I know that brand. Quaz5000 said, I have a question that y'all had in Anaheim. Upset I missed it. Sorry, Quaz. But you can get the footage soon. Is it better to sell a beat as a lease or an exclusive? So, Trizza had a lot to say, and Diego Ave had a lot to say about that.
Yeah, they definitely did.
Yeah.
I'll be honest with you, man. I'm not much on the beat selling online, so this question might not be for me. Yeah. But I will say, keep in mind, who do you want to be ultimately? Do you want to be a lease guy? I don't want to say bargain, but do you want to be doing a whole bunch of leases? Yeah. When it comes to exclusives, okay, well, now you're probably dealing with a different clientele, a different type of clientele. Do you know where that type of clientele is? So however you choose to work the system, you can make it work for you. But I think I said this in Anaheim too. You can sell one thing for $1,000 or 1,000 things for $1. It's still the same amount of money. Right. It's just the different methodologies to how you get it.
That's exactly what I was going to say. You took my point. But again, are you B2C, which is direct to customer or consumer, or are you B2B, which is business to business, which is you to the artist or label who's going to put it out eventually to the consumer? You have to decide who's your target. And that's a business principle. I'm reading the comments from Facebook now. Somebody said, if you came into music production to just sell beats and make money, quit while you're at it. I don't think that's... A lot of people try to like make music about like some emotional feeling. But at the end of the day, if you couldn't feed your family and survive, you would not be doing music. If you're putting your family at risk by doing music, why would you do music?
Right. Well, that's my whole thing. People get romantic about this. Yeah. You can get romantic about your music, but unfortunately, you can't get romantic about your business. Yeah. And you're in the music business. There are two sides to it. So you're having an art that you can be romantic and just objective about, and then you're transferring it into a commerce world where now it's based on people's opinion and what they're willing to pay for. It's a very... confusing paradigm, but just keep in mind, you can be romantic about one part to a certain degree, and you can't be romantic at all about the second part.
Here's someone who kind of pushes on beyond that point. He says, he was responding, he says, no, I would like to sell beats to pay for my music equipment, and then I don't really want to sell beats. I want to produce my own music and record vocals over them. So he's selling beats to become his own artist. That's interesting. That's
going in. That's nice.
That's the cool conundrum there. So there's a long-term game, and I'm recently starting to realize if I record an album, that's studio time. I gotta hire an engineer, a mixing engineer who knows how to work the board, which is gonna be Ron D. Sylvester most likely. I gotta shoot the music video. It's another cost. I gotta have nice clothes. Another cost. I gotta have, you know, models in the video. That's another cost. That's like four major costs in that one song or one album just to be an artist. And if I don't have any skills on throwing live shows or any traction or demand, you're in the negative still. So again, it's about this music business. You got to learn how to create value at the end of the day. Yeah. But that's my goal. When I got to La Jolla from April 23rd to about the 28th, Curtis King's going to throw a thing in the 28th of April in LA somewhere, I guess. I think he's still throwing it. So that's going to be nice. I hope I didn't leak the information. I probably did. I need to shut up before I get in trouble. But anyway, I think he's going to have something April 28th. And I was going to be out there for a business meeting for my mentor from April 23rd to the 25th. So I just stayed till the weekend to fill in the gap. So I was like, since I'm going to be out there for like 5 days, why not just film a music video at a nice spot, you know? So that now I have a challenge. Like I have to record a song. I have to go to the studio. I have to get it mixed. I have to have the idea for the music video. Make it happen during that week. Get it done. Get it processed. And I realize it costs a lot of money. So that's a good business plan. You know, use it to fuel something else. But I wouldn't say selling beats online is like, I'm only doing it because, you know, it's not, you don't have to justify it. I don't think. Like I'm only doing it because I want to, you know, a lot of people do that thing. Somebody said do a production camp. Young Chambers. He says Zaytoven has a production camp. Okay. I think they do. Actually, now I'm thinking about it. I think doesn't iStandard have like producer beat camp or something like that?
Oh, they do have.
Yeah, I'm thinking. Yeah, I'm thinking. I'm like, yo, why don't we come up with the producer?
And the funny thing is, I'm a speaker or a judge or both. At every Atlanta beat camp, some that aren't in Atlanta, I just totally blanked out on that. But yeah, they have beat camp too. Literally called beat camp.
I think what I was thinking in my head is like an actual campsite. Maybe that's what I'm thinking of. Me too. Maybe that's why I didn't link it up. Well, shout out to iStandard. They have pretty cool things. And shout out to, what's his name? Don from iStandard. I didn't meet Jay Hatch yet. I didn't meet him yet.
Yeah,
who's
yeah,
the guy? Scissor?
Yeah. Sizz. He Sizz. Actually he lives out here.
215 Scissor.
Yep.
Shout out to him too. Okay, I'm reading back in the comments again. Da, da, da. Which plugin should I invest in? I'm looking forward to something similar to Citrus or Serum. So I guess like a okay. What do you think? If they had to buy one synth plugin,
a synthy type of plugin or something in that realm.
Mm-hmm.
Dune is pretty cool. Dune 2. It just reminds me of like a Silent or Serum, you know what I mean? Something in that realm. And if you're going for a retro sound, Diva is pretty cool.
Diva, wow, he hit you with that silent gem.
Yeah.
I like Diva for the sound design capabilities.
Diva is dope. Your CPU, though, will hate you. Diva. If you go to their website, one of the first things you see is warning, our VSTs are very CPU intensive.
Wow, and they get it out the way.
Yeah, they do. Transparency. But you know what? That caused me the other day, this is a quick side note, it made me, you know, I'm always trying to build or invent something. It made me build a rack in Ableton that saves CPU.
That saves CPU inside the DAW that takes up CPU.
Yes, I had 16 instances of Omnisphere loaded up, and I was only using the CPU of one at any given time. If people are interested in that rack, I may come out with it. I may sell it. I realized I was building that to build a bigger thing. But since everything is just subsystems to build a big system, I realized that I build these certain... Like Ferrari builds great cars, but look at their factory. The machinery that builds their cars are top-of-the-line systems within themselves. Mm. So that's kind of how I look at sound design.
I'm just shocked that that's even possible. Like what... Inside the DAW, you can do something to save the DAW's own resources.
Yeah, and it doesn't take any third-party applications. It's all native things. It's really what is going on, not what's doing it.
Hmm. Yeah, I think that's wild, man. If you release that, or at least partner up with a DAW, well, Ableton to release it, that's insane, man. I can't even think on that level. I'm not that experienced with DSP and programming and all that. Hey, what can I use to half speed a sound?
Gross beat or halftime.
I like how you just like before I even get to the next question, you answered it. That's awesome.
I'm still in the bullet round. I'm still bullet mindset.
Yeah, I need to go faster, right? I think, yeah, this is the question we left off on, how to format a song for CD, but let's skip that one. What's your opinion on people that claim that hip hop is dead?
Where are you looking? You're looking in a graveyard. Look where hip hop is alive. It's alive everywhere. Like I said, there's a million Spotify playlists that are curated for real hip hop every day. Not just old hip hop, like new hip hop that came out yesterday. Like the hip hop that you like, whatever you want to hear. You can make your own radio station off of one song on any of these platforms. With more people making music than ever, more ways to consume the exact music that you want than ever, I don't see how anybody can say anything is dead. Hell, rock is alive if you look at it from that perspective.
Mm-hmm. And that's what I love about, you mentioned playlists and all these things. We couldn't measure that before. There was no way to measure how many times somebody played Kanye West's Flashing Lights off the CD from Graduation on his own CD player. Mm-hmm. You couldn't track that, but now we can see, okay, the related artists you spoke about earlier, we can see that. We can see how many times this person hit replay or rewind or whatever. Like where they kept rewinding. We can see exactly that part of the song. We can see there's so much fantastic opportunity in the music industry, but I think there's a weird battle. And I meant to mention this before, but Spotify did something. They're going to release something. I should know. Let me Google it so I don't sound dumb. Hold on a second. Spotify did something recently where people felt slighted about the... Spotify launches a new hub dedicated to highlighting social causes. That's not it. What is it? Where is it at? Here it is. As Spotify prepares to go public, that's what it is. Spotify's going public, so they're going on the stock market. music industry divided on the royalty system, because I guess they feel like they're putting all this work in, but they're not getting any stock options or any, you know. So I don't know. The music industry is at its point where it's probably going to grow into something completely new, but at the same time, we're hearing complaints about people getting underpaid. So it's like massive opportunity, but they're underpaying people.
Exactly. And it's funny, people asking what music is going to sound like or how is music going to change. Really, the question is the music industry. That's what's changing faster than music by far. True. And honestly, by the end of this year, it won't resemble what it is now. Hmm.
What if we had like an Uber for production?
Like, wait, you got to explain that to me.
An Uber for production. So the idea is you could be anywhere, whatever city, and you have certified Uber producers or whatever. And wow. You go to their home studios. They're not necessarily like an Uber. You don't necessarily have to go into Cadillac. You can get in somebody's like Toyota, small car. Mm-hmm. You can go to their small home studio, or you can order the XL Uber producer who has the whole, you know, whatever.
I think that's dope, man.
Let's
set it up.
Let's do it, man. Let's link up with somebody. I don't know. But that's a hilarious idea. I think that's funny. But I don't know where that idea came from. I think because I'm reading a question that says, from Kush Crazy says, what's a good starting rate on a beat?
Once again, I've never sold beats online. I don't know what the market is, but you should at least know what the market is, know what your capabilities and what you think your value is, and base it off of that.
Right. Here's a quick way to come up with prices. Look at the end product that the person is selling and calculate your just due for putting into that end product. So, you know, the reason these models can get like 20K for a photo shoot is because the end product is going to be like a makeup line or something that's going to sell 20 million. So it makes sense to give the model 20,000 or whatever for that instance, because she's contributing to something that's worth 20 million. But when you're talking to a person who just has an idea for a clothing line and they just started, are they going to pay you 20,000 to be a model? Is that fair? You know, unless they're trying to get your celebrity involved some type of way, it's not really worth it to them to pay 20,000. So you have to either the deal is big enough, whatever it is in life, either the deal is big enough to take an equity stake, or you just charge a flat fee around the board. And it's up to your business model what you charge. So, somebody said, I just woke up. What the heck is wrong with me? Because I said, if you're still asleep, remember?
Definitely did. That's they didn't wake up at 8, but they close enough to it.
Yeah. Man. A lot of comments, but no questions. My first blog series was The Elements of here's the blog guy, Chauncey.
Okay.
He said, my first blog series was The Elements of a Song. I was going to have an EP to go along with the promotion of the blog. It's new, so I'm building. So I guess The Elements of a Song, and he was going to break down his own song, I guess. That makes sense.
Not a bad idea at all, because you're giving people value and you're also showcasing what you do at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Not bad.
And it's something that the majority can understand. You're not like talking about how to sound design the kick in your song. You're just saying how I arranged the song or how I thought about it. So that way it makes it a little more interesting. Just like the documentaries on certain places make certain places more interesting. Django says, what's up, game? I'm in the building. Shout out to Django. Red Master says, can I get a composer deal with a publisher while being abroad? So I've never heard any stories where somebody would get signed abroad. I don't know if you mean, like, do you have to come to the U.S., or are you saying how to get a deal where you're at, but still get a deal, a pub deal?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know which way.
You think about it. Whenever you sign a contract or anything, it's bound to that land. So if you're signing a contract for America, that's going to stand up in American court. So deals go the same way. So chances are you're going to have to move to America if you're doing stuff like that. Or, you know, whatever, they might have an affiliate brand or umbrella brand that's in their country, like an ambassador over in their country.
Yeah.
Da, da, da. When do you know when your beats are ready to sell? We went over that earlier, but you can kind of reiterate.
Once again, what's the feedback that you get from other people? And also start with the DOD or a definition of done when you start a beat. If you're one of those people that suffer from overrun or overproduction, set a DOD.
What did you call it? Overrun?
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's been done, but you just,
is for some reason, right. Is that a computer term when you overclock? Oh, I'm thinking overclock. I'm sorry.
Overflow. Well, you can overclock it in the Stack Overflow as well, but all the same thing. Meaning okay. You're still putting input when no more input is really necessary.
You see how many? Do you see how quick this man is with his answers? That's because it's from experience. He doesn't even need to think. That's why you need to be around us in the Music Producer Mastermind meeting in New York. It's going to be a 48 Lounge, high-end luxury event. This is not somebody's backyard. This is downtown Manhattan. This is the height of New York. This is an experience you need to be around, to be around people who are about it. Sound Oracle has years and years and years of experience. Insane amounts of experience. I myself have my own experience, a different experience. Trizza has his own experience, and we're willing to share this information. And not only us, but you get to be around your brothers in production and be around people who are about getting to that next level. So again, March 31st at 48 Lounge in New York, when I lock down the venue, tickets are going to start at 150. Why? Because we want to separate people who are dabbling from the people who aren't, you know, who are serious. So the people who are not serious from the people who are serious. So tickets start at 150. Okay. It's New York. Everything is expensive in New York anyway. But again, this is going to be luxurious. I want you to dress up in your flex attire. I want you to dress up in your Gucci's. What somebody say your Gucci flops and your whatever, your Louis belts.
FTP.
Huh? FTP. Whatever that is. And I want you to, you know, show up prepared and just be ready to explode into growth. Because that's what happened from the last Mastermind meeting out in Anaheim. Beats Music exploded into like a whole new being. Puneet from FNS Productions exploded into a new being. I'm trying to think of the highlighted folks. Melian exploded into a whole new being. All I see her doing is shows after show after show.
Right. Weddings. I think even the studio might have evolved after that event too.
Yeah, even the studio has their own seminars now for like vocal training camps and stuff. So shout out to Love and Laughter Music Group. So like this, I want you to understand the magnitude of being around and energy like us. We're literally motivating people to the extreme of starting things. Like even RJ from Track Gods is now on a whole new wave because he got so inspired by those 4 days or however many days he showed up. I want to say 2 days. Only 2 days, 2 days transformed his whole beingness, I'd say, to where he's pushing out ideas like crazy.
Yeah. Gabriel, who's not even into music, he took on a new mindset afterwards.
Really? Do you know his Instagram?
I don't. What? Yeah. I don't.
Why? Are you just mean in that moment? What do you mean?
Yeah. He was talking to me. It was during one of the breaks. And, you know, he's in the jewelry industry or whatever, but he was inspired and took on a whole new mind shift. Mm-hmm. I got word Chris Thompson, I think his name was.
Oh, he was there. Yeah,
Chris, did you see what he wrote on LinkedIn? He wrote a awesome, great review on LinkedIn. My assistant sent it to me yesterday. Yeah. Just an awesome write-up. So it's great to see how these people were transformed just by that experience.
Yeah, I mean, that's how much power is in this one moment of time. There's no way to really get it on film either because half the stuff that went down was off camera. So just imagine. I mean, and then we only put up 1 day of the seminar on YouTube. And that's just one of the days from these seminars. So I want you to understand the power that's going to be in New York, March 31st. Come join us at the 48 Lounge. Again, it's no age restrictions. We will have drinks. We'll have food. We will have tons and tons of experience and experience share and knowledge share. That's what it's about. We're going to have networking. We're going to have fun. It's not going to be a boring, you know, speaking of 48 Lounge, here's the proposal for it right now. So nice. Shout out to Brian and his assistant Christina. So we're gonna lock this down. I'm gonna go for it. Tickets are gonna start at 150. Again, we're separating people who are serious from people who aren't serious. We're gonna have fun. This is not about being boring. It's gonna be on a Saturday night, March 31st, and I got the proposal email right here. So it's a long email. I thought it was readable, but it's super long, so I thought I could read it live. But Here's the intro to locking down the event. Dear Carlin Hines, which is my government name, 48 Lounge, centrally located in Midtown Manhattan, is an award-winning multifaceted event venue. Known for elevated service and premium product, 48 Lounge specializes in creating the ideal atmosphere for your VIP event. We are honored to be considered and look forward to the opportunity to provide you and your guests the ultimate 48 Lounge experience. So again, this is Midtown Manhattan, New York. What are you doing on March 31st? If you're going out to a club in your city, cancel. Come to New York. You don't need to waste time March 31st. If you're anywhere near the area, I don't care if you fly in from California, you need to be here March 31st. We're going to change your life instantly because you're going to be around so much energy of progressing that it's going to progress you just from being around that energy. It's insane. Sorry, I was so caught up in the email. I forgot to read the comments. My bad. We're still in our bullet round. Okay. No more Blues Clues. What social media accounts do you think are most important to producers busy? Oh, shout out to Kevin. Sorry. I know Gamertag. Shout out to you. What social media accounts do you think are most important to producers? That's what you and I.
Okay. Most people know me from Instagram. I got my start on Instagram. So I'm going to go with Instagram first, but that's my answer, Instagram. But I'm also on Twitter, Facebook, Google Plus, Pinterest, Tumblr. I'm on everything.
Pinterest, yeah.
I'm on Pinterest. Wow. You understand? But okay. Once again, it's simple and easy. Listen, technology, you can syndicate yourself.
Mm-hmm. That's what it's about.
Yeah.
Being exactly. Omnipresent, being everywhere at once, syndication. The best social media account, I'd say you're probably eventually going to need a Facebook or an Instagram because that's the ad. Once you get into advertising, that's going to be the way to do it. And you need to build up that information so that you have data for Facebook to use when you start advertising. So I'd say get a Facebook page as early as you can. Set up your Facebook pixel. I'm not going to get into all the details about that, but do that. And what else? Instagram is like the new thing now. But your whole point is with social media, eventually you're going to run ads. So just be conscious of that. And where do you like their ad system? Where do you like the cost per ads and all that? Different social medias have different rates. What do you think about the free music distribution sites for artists? The free distribution. So I don't know what those are. So they something like... TuneCore or DistroKid or something like that.
I haven't heard any bad things about them, but once again, I'm not there.
Sorry. Better by the Second says, how many mastermind meetings are you doing? We did one in Anaheim in January, late January. We hope to do this, have one or two big events per year, but these aren't the huge events. These are like the really intimate get to know you events. So this is our second one. Yeah, I mean, at BusyWorks Beats, I don't want to include you if you don't want to be included, but no, Oracle's been at both.
It's the second one, definitely.
Yeah. Second one, but we want to you to understand that these are going to transform your business, regardless if we have them two times or four times a year. Hold on one second. Da-da-da. Okay. So how much time you got? We are 1 hour and 56 minutes. I'm just checking on you.
No, I'm good. I got some time.
Okay, cool. B. Robin says, I'm getting better at hip hop beats and I'm also learning things. Learning things so I can make standalone electronic trance music. Is that a good route to go? He said, I'm getting better at hip hop and I'm also learning things so I can make standalone. So I think his ultimate goal is to make trance music and electronic music. But should he go through hip hop to get there? I think that's his question.
It depends on what your reasoning is for it. Mm-hmm. I want to say that you had a reason for picking that route, picking hip hop to advance in a total different genre. Mm-hmm. It really just depends on your reasoning. And I hope you have a reason. There's a quote. I want to say it's Albert Einstein, but I could be wrong. Nothing is worth doing. The point of the quote is, if you're doing something extremely well and working hard on it, it's not worth doing if it's not something that you should be doing in the first place.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So that's why I'm saying I hope you have a reason for doing that. Otherwise, you will be doing something extremely well and efficiently that does not need to be done.
Like, I can tie my shoes at light speed.
Yeah. Yeah,
and nobody cares.
Yeah, you don't have to do that.
Yeah. That's a perfect answer. And I lost point of the chat because I'm trying to do 8 things at one time.
Thanks. And I butchered the quote, but you get the gist.
Yeah, we definitely get that gist. Music production says, can you talk about how to come up with a producer name that appeals to the mainstream and can be destined for success? Wow.
Okay. Wait. And that person's name is Music Production?
That's hilarious, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. First of all, how'd you get that name? Yeah. Second of all, wow. You know, I don't know. There's so many ways to go about that. My name came about by mistake. So, I don't know. But I will say this. It's not really so much about the name as it is about the quality of the brand. For instance, think about how many rappers you heard. The first time you heard their name, you're like, that's the dumbest name I ever heard. And then they became household names. Yeah. And it didn't sound so stupid anymore. So, it's not so much about the name. It's what's behind the name.
Like, who would have thought Tekashi 6ix9ine or Ace Boogie with the hoodie or what's that guy's name? Fetty Wap.
Yeah. Sounded crazy. But now you don't think twice when you hear those names, the household names.
So. Or even I just thought of a longer one. I Love Makanan. Like, it's all one word.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'm reading comments from the past again. Revenant Knight says, how do you sample songs legally?
You can clear them, mm-hmm. or you can use a service like TrackLib or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, TrackLib. Sorry, I'm trying to read ahead. TrackLib built out like a library where it's kind of like understood that you can clear it for a certain price, but still there's labels and records out there that you can't clear on TrackLib. You know, it doesn't have everything in the music library, but they're trying to pull from random sources. Yeah. A weird legal thing. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Also, depending on the type of music you make, don't overlook the fact that there are sound designers.
True.
There are royalty-free things, and royalty-free things are really good now. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like how people used to look at FL like, oh, it's the little doll or the Fisher-Price doll, and then FL is now a beast.
Mm-hmm.
That's what a lot of royalty-free samples and loops are now.
Right.
You know, they were just little stupid loops, but now it's like, wow, people making entire songs. I think you were talking about on the last show, one of my melody loops is all the music for the song with Drake and Trouble that Mike Will produced.
Literally, yeah.
Royalty-free loop. You know what I mean? Mike Will didn't go somewhere and dig for that sample and have to clear it.
Mm-hmm.
Just came to my site and bought it. And boom, there you go.
And that's the modern way of collabing with producers that you love. Grab their loops. And Oracle's loops are not like the loops that come in GarageBand where it's like boom, you know those weird loops that you're like, how do I even combine these to make anything modern? They're way different. You know, you got to go to soundoracle.net and it's just like collabing with them. And you don't have to worry about paying, you know, sample clearance fee.
Right.
Royalties, all the legalities of it, it's built to work. So go to soundoracle.net. I mean, I use the sounds all the time, and whether we're doing a trap track or some R&B thing or some abstract thing, your sounds work it in because you do stuff differently. You have staple sounds, but like you said, the way you introduce your creative sounds is by kind of giving people what they're used to, like trap or something, but then blending your perspective to what's just cool ideas.
Yeah, exactly. And just being different. Like I said, I've been sound designing for Timbaland and Polo. So you're going to have to be different. You know what I mean? You can't just, otherwise, why would they even come to me? They could just go somewhere and get some regular loops if that's what they wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, saying all that to say, I put a lot of pride. I put a lot of pride in it, and I wouldn't have you out there looking crazy.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And you know what? I'm going to show people how to, this is Louis King. Speaking of Louis King. And we're going to show people how, yeah, hey, buddy. We're going to show people how to use your loops, because I feel like people don't understand how to use loops to the full degree. Because I was using the other day Articulate like it was, like I chopped out a certain part of the vocal, then I added like mono legato so we could pitch slur. We did a bunch of stuff. But people don't know they can do that with samples sometimes. But even if you don't know how to do that, that's what loops are built to do. In Austin? Is anything going down in Austin?
I don't know about Austin.
Okay, I was just checking. I'll be in New York March 31st.
Dope.
Just to let them know. Cool. But that's Louis King from the Music Producer Mastermind meeting. He also came by to share. He was a touring artist and just shared his experience. I mean, we had so many. That was like action packed. It was so much experiential knowledge, you know, that was shared during that mastermind meeting. And I think that's what is going to make that one stand out from the rest. The one in New York is going to be not only about sharing these gems and, you know, things that really separate us from the rest, but it's also about the networking aspect. Because again, I realized that the first one, I didn't give people enough time to really get to know each other. And that kind of, you know, we did the little after hours thing where we would hang till like 2 a.m. each day.
Right.
Or 12 or whatever it was. But yeah, that added up over time. I didn't realize that I was getting hit with that bill. So this time you can't play around in New York. We got to
go kind of build that time into the thing.
Yeah, we got to leave time for people to chat. Okay. What is the reality of trying to become a professional engineer in a studio?
Quite doable. Mm-hmm. Honestly, that the route to that is more apparent than most other careers in the music business. Mm-hmm. Because you want to be an engineer, and you mentioned you want to be an engineer in a major studio. That's as simple as interning.
Yep. And even at the studio that I'm learning from right now under Ron DiSilvestro, he doesn't have a lot of, I'm not saying he, but I mean, there aren't a lot of people like, oh, I want to be an intern. I want to be an intern. Not saying that that's a bad thing. I'm saying that there's nobody, you don't have to compete against anybody really to even intern. I'm just saying. And then on top of that, like in the rock world, setting up stuff takes time. So if he can train somebody on how to set up the mics and set up the cables and set up the whatever, the headphone towers, that's going to save him time and energy and he can focus on something else. So having interns helps his workflow, and you learn for free, you know. Yes, you're setting up stuff for free, but you're learning stuff for free. So learning is not cheap, you know.
You know what? And that's funny that you mentioned that. I was talking to somebody in my consultation the other day, and they were talking about interning. And I was saying, not only are you learning, you get on-the-job access to a mentor. Or it's like you go to a mastermind meeting every time you go to work, and you learn from somebody that you look up to. That's an amazing experience. I wish I had looked at internship that same way when I was younger.
Right.
But I mean, it's such an amazing experience to have access to people with the knowledge. And not only are they telling you, they're showing you, and you get to physically do it and learn yourself. Mm-hmm. Amazing. It doesn't get any better than that.
It really doesn't. I mean, the stuff that Ron's showing us alone is insane. It's a different world, because I didn't come from the recording side of this world. So it's like a whole new world for me, dealing with the recording and the strategies and thought processes, dealing with hardware that's like $60,000 in a console alone. So it's a lot of leverage. You can leverage these assets. Just like they're leveraging, chances are the engineer you're talking to is renting out from the bigger studio. They don't own the studio. They're just renting under the bigger studio. So the more you can leverage and leverage and leverage, the better you'll be as far as learning hands-on if you want to be an engineer. But, you know, it depends on the city. Again, this stuff is like invite only half the time. Mm-hmm. Or you might have to pay to get into a certain thing to where they will teach you and maybe consider you to be an intern. So you have to do a lot more research. It's going to change. Edman the Great says, your point number. He says, I meant as a producer, how can I take advantage in my meeting with the people/lady from the Grammy chapter of Atlanta? I don't understand this question. Let me read it back.
Oh, okay. I think I get it. But yeah, go ahead. Read it back. I think I get it, though.
How can I take advantage in my meeting? What is
he
it?
He has a meeting with somebody from the Grammy chapter of Atlanta, and he wants to know, I guess, how to get the most out of that meeting.
Okay. I've never been to a Grammy chapter meeting, so I don't know.
Maybe I think she's just part of the Grammy chapter, and he gets the chance to meet with her. So he's
Okay.
trying to build a meaningful relationship with her,
Oh,
and I
I
guess he
see.
wants to know like what to ask her or how to conduct himself in the meeting or something like that.
Well, you have to ask yourself, what is she trying to talk to you about? Like, what value are you displaying that she wants? Because she clearly wants something. Everybody acts in self-interest. There's not one person that truly acts out of altruism, which is like sacrificing themselves for the greater good. People all have some form of self-interest. So what is she going to get out of it? That why does she even call you to a meeting if she's not getting anything out of it?
Man, you know what? You said something that's kind of profound right there. It's not even what you said, it's the perspective that you approached it from. Because when people meet with people like that, especially somebody in a higher position, they're usually like, I want to meet with this person because I want to get signed or I want to get whatever.
Right.
Your perspective was, since everyone wants something, what does the other person want? People don't even consider that the other person wants something because they're so self-interested and self-centered, they know what they want and what they're coming to the meeting for. But the key to getting what you want is to know what the other person wants and to provide some type of value. In return, people feel naturally reciprocal and they want to give back to you. So that's a great perspective that you came from.
And that's awesome. I read a book called How to Get Whatever You Want. Now, it sounds like a vulgar book, like how to manipulate people into giving you whatever you want. But the trick to the story was that you have to know about people so that you can give them what they want. And in return, you get what you want. That was the whole caveat to the story. And it was like a personality book. I forget what it's called now, but the author shouted me out on Twitter. So shout out to him. Sorry, I forgot the name of the book. Let me see if it's in here somewhere. No, it's not. I don't see it anywhere. It's orange. It's an orange book. It was in one of my live streams a while back. Like How to Grind as a Music Producer. I mentioned it then. So it's in form. It's in video form somewhere. What? Da, da, da. Oh, down one says Sound Oracle. Good looking out. I don't know
No
what
doubt.
what. I know we're a little behind the times, but shout out to you. Xavier says Sound Oracle's the effing goat, bruh. I need to start studying how to build these racks. Oh, people are saying sell the rack. Okay.
Okay.
Da, da, da. You have to love it either way. Somebody said you have to love, I guess, music either way. It can be a roller coaster. The ultimate is always making money with what you love doing.
Yeah, and you have to preserve your passion. I'm not gonna go off on a rant about that, but even when you're doing what you love, when that becomes your way to make money, and it's your business, usually if you're starting a business, it's not your business at first, it's your job. And anything that becomes a job, it loses a little bit of its sheen. So if you don't have your determination, your passion, or your reason why you're doing it, you'll burn out super fast.
That's super true, man. It's like the one, you know, when you get caught on something in your business, like a managerial thing or like a technical thing that just has to get done. And it's like it takes so long, but like you're getting burned out mentally. And you're like, I'm glad this is not my whole business because I couldn't do this every single day for the rest of my life or whatever. It's only
Facts.
one piece of the business, but man, there are people who look at Excel sheets every day and get hype. So shout out to them.
Yeah.
Well, Ableton.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I'm just joking.
No, that's pretty accurate, though.
Make Humanity Great Again says, were you referring to how to win friends and influence people? No, I
The
wasn't
Dale.
mentioning. Huh?
I was going to mention that that's the Godfather one, the Dale Carnegie book. Yeah, but I know you were talking about a different book.
Yeah, it's called I forget. I don't know. It's the art, I think it's called The Art of People. That's what it's called. The Art of People. Let me Google it so I know. The Art
I like that.
People book. Yeah, The Art of People, 11 simple people skills that will get you everything you want. Now, it seems kind of vulgar and like self flattering on the in the title, but the trick to it all is that it's about giving other people what they want. So that's the whole twist to that story. Da-da-do. So glad I managed to catch the stream. My name is Zeus Savage, by the way. You have honestly helped me get to where I am now, and I want to thank you. FL Gang. Shout out to Revenant Knight. Zeus. Zeus Savage, sorry.
Young Zeus Savage. That's probably that's the most brutal name I heard all day.
I don't think I've told people to ask questions, so we need your questions. I don't think I've ever prepped them to even ask questions. But Marcus Ford says, "All your I didn't read this right. Are y'all bringing the mastermind meeting to the Midwest at all game? What's the Midwest? Is that like there's only like one city I know in the Midwest. That's Chicago.
Yeah,
like a city, not like a
yeah.
As long as we don't get shot.
That's a fact.
Chicago has a bad stigma, but I think a couple people from the survey wanted to go to Chicago. But down the line, we'll think about it. Could I DM you your opinion on ideas I had for a name? This is Music Production, who wanted to come up with a a production name.
Oh, I don't know who he was talking to. He was talking to me or you?
He added me. So the thing is, I don't check DMs on YouTube. So, and I don't give out my email address, so you have to talk to my support team. Maybe they'll give you a nickname. Or ask people in the chat. They're your peers. My question is, with how many way to sample a song, is it even considered stealing and or fair use? So like when people pitch down a sample or like take a small chop of a sample, is that fair use or is that justifiable for royalties? Again, we're not lawyers by any means.
Yeah, not at all. And the question sounds like more of a moral question.
A moral question. You
know, it seems to be one of those things like, oh, if I take it and I flip it and no one knows where it's from, do I still have to pay it? At least that's what I get from that question. Yeah. That's a moral question right there. I can't answer that.
If I have $100 bills in my hand and nobody knows I took it from the old lady's purse, did I steal it? That's kind of like, right. I mean, but music is different because... Like, how do you own a snare drum? Because we can all have the Yamaha drum kit, and we record the same snare, but I chopped the snare from your record, but it's still the Yamaha snare that I can buy from any store. So it's like, that's the tricky part of music. Like, how deep down do you, like, what microscopic particle do you own? But as far as, like, a song, we went over this before. I don't want to be too boring. Copyright law, as far as fair use, music is considered a highly creative piece of content, which means it's not like a sidewalk outside. It's very creative and very thought out and whatever. So when you sample music, it's not necessarily fair use because it's a highly creative art piece or whatever, highly creative content piece. But when you start getting granular and stuff, that's where the debate kicks up. Tuned in a few minutes ago. What did I miss? You missed a lot.
Oh yeah.
But as long as you didn't miss the music producer mastermind meeting. In I almost said Anaheim. No, Music Producer Mastermind meeting March 31st. It's going to be in Manhattan, New York.
Yes, sir.
What's it called? Apple City or City Apple? What's it called? The Big Apple. Apple. Yeah, the City of Dreams.
It's not the City Apple though.
The City Apple. The City of Dreams are going to New York, Manhattan, and it's going to be in the upscale part of Manhattan. And again, this is a luxury event, so I want you to dress super well. Tickets start at $150. We're going to have them available soon. It's at 48 Lounge. In New York, and I just got the proposal email, so I have to go through that and sign whatever contract or whatever it was. But again, that's March 31st, 2018. So if you're in the New York area or any states near, or you want to fly in, you got to be there for March 31st. We're going to transform your life instantly when you come to this Music Producer Mastermind meeting. Because again, you want to be around the energy of people that are about something. And when's the last time you were around people who are about something? Let's just be honest. Besides this live podcast now, when do you really surround yourself with people who are about something? And there's just something about being there in person that, you know, you catch that motivation bug. It's going to transform your life. So you got to be there March 31st, 48 Lounge in New York. We're going to sell tickets soon. And it's any age. I think somebody asked about age earlier. Any age. But to drink and stuff, you got to be 21, obviously, with the bartender. Shout out to Melinda, our new female in the stream. You should come by, Melinda. Okay, let's see. Again, a lot of people are just chatting back and forth. No real questions. Let's go back to the beginning of the chat. Do you think it's possible to make money in the music industry when you don't want the fame?
Definitely. Mm-hmm. Definitely. 99% of the people that work in the music industry don't have fame. You know about the artists. For each artist, there's a team. And for each of those teams, they're probably sub-teams. So yeah, most people that are in the music industry don't have fame. A lot of people make very decent livings, and a lot of them more so than the artists.
That's the beautiful part about the music industry, especially in Nashville. That's like a whole economy based around session musicians, where they don't necessarily have a band name. Well, they could be a band, like 1500 or nothing. Technically, they're a band, but technically, they're also session musicians as well. So they kind of play that their brand around like that.
Right.
Because they did stuff with Jay-Z. Huh? Shout out who?
Shout out to the homies, 1500 or nothing.
Oh, yeah.
Look out for something. I'm doing something special with them soon, too.
Oh, wow. I'm picking your thoughts apart. I didn't know. I was on that wave. Awesome, yeah. Man. They're building like a massive school down in LA or something. They show pictures of it. They're building this huge school, supposedly for like music production, I think. So shout out to 1500 or nothing, man. They're just doing insane things. How are you, Melinda? Melinda's already getting hit on already in the chat.
Don't post no wedding ring emojis. Be easy.
Be easy. But shout out to Melinda. What plugin is that? What plugin is what? I'm not sure what he's talking about. Yeah. Oh, he said there's a free plugin I use. Sorry, I'm reading comments. Okay.
Gotcha.
There are some sounds I like on my There are some sounds I like on my keyboard. Is there any way I can transfer them to FL Studio? So I guess he uses like a keyboard workstation. Is there any way to get those to FL? Or I mean, to any DAW.
There is, actually. You could sample it. And I don't mean like you play a note and then you sample it like that. There are actual programs that you could use. One of my favorite is called Sample Robot. And you can literally sample hardware stuff. You can sample VSTs. There used to be one back in the day called High Life that would rip patches. There's also DirectWave that used to be, made by ImageLine, that used to come with FL Studio. I'm not sure if it still does, but DirectWave also does the same thing. So there are three programs right there.
Dang, I didn't even think he was going that deep. I thought he just meant, how do you get the sound from his keyboard into FL? You went on how to actually sample the sounds.
Yeah, like, yeah, I thought he wanted to like rip it. So yeah, you can rip a whole keyboard. I've done it.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Yeah, I was going to say the simple perspective is you plug in your... Ow, my back. Sorry. Ow, that hurt. You plug in your audio outputs of your hardware synth or keyboard. You need a quarter-inch cable. You plug that into something called an audio interface, which goes into your computer. Then you go into your computer and you activate a track and you make it an audio track and you make sure the monitoring is on so you can hear it. And then you record whatever you want to record over your keyboard. Now, there's other ways to do it. You can do MIDI out from your DAW to your keyboard, so you don't even have to touch the keyboard. You can just switch the sounds on the keyboard, but you can play with your MIDI controller. So there's a lot of options for you. You could sample it, you could play MIDI out, or you can just play by hand and record the audio into your DAW. So I'm not sure which part of the what do you want it to do exactly, but Fussy says, what's the pay difference between a song that sells 1K copies, 1,000 copies, and a song that sells 1,000,000 copies? So I guess we were talking about streaming and how people are getting underpaid now.
The pay difference, whatever percentage you're getting times 1,000 or times 1,000,000.
that's a very easy way to think about it. I like that. It's simple and sweet. Throw some nugs on it. Says, are the Fab Filter plugins for mixing really worth the money?
In my opinion, yeah. If you look at any of the mixing tutorials that I have on soundoracle.net, Realistic, who does my tutorials, he's an awesome engineer. Mm-hmm. He swears by Fab Filter. And I think every tutorial he uses something by Fab Filter.
True.
Yeah, I become I had a lot of this stuff before, but I become more of a fan since I've been working with him. Mm-hmm. And the good thing about Fab Filter, the two things I like, they're highly visual, and on things like the EQ, you can solo bands, and that's really important.
That's what we need, that solo button to hit that frequency right when we... Exactly, you said it perfectly. And I think it does mid-side too, maybe. I think it does.
Yes. We, not to do the whole tutorial thing, we did a tutorial on how to make your track sound wider using mid-side compression.
Mm-hmm.
And it was Fab Filter stuff that we were using.
Dope. See, there it is. Mid-side compression. See, people don't. That's when you learn mastering or mixing on a higher level. You think mid-side versus just like, do I add a compressor? You start thinking, do I add a compressor on the mono or the stereo or do I EQ the. So that's a whole different level. I think I shared the article about the stereo imaging plugins or the how to widen your mix, something like that.
Oh, yeah, using stereo tools. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I just because I'm like I'm running out of like stuff to put in my automated social media thing. So I'm like instead of because they don't like YouTube links anymore on Facebook. So I'm sick of like writing Facebook manually. It takes so much time. I'm like, why don't I share the stuff that I'm actually, you know, like Oracle stuff. He has a whole blog. Why don't I share Triz's stuff? It just didn't dawn on me to do it till yesterday.
See,
Because it.
that's a good move, but that's a key. What you're witnessing is my man adapting. You got your business has to adapt. There you go.
Yeah, it just didn't. It just clicks too late sometimes. Edmund the Great says, here's the guy who said he's meeting with the Grammy lady. He says, I got connected with her through one of her friends. She's hosting some music producer event in ATL, and I'm also meeting with her. I'm trying to network as much as possible, but yeah, you're right. So I think he was saying that we're right about like, what does she want out of it?
Right. Okay. Cool.
I don't know.
I have another suggestion for him. When is the meeting? On did he say? What?
When I would have to go back in the chat a
But
little too
not.
far. I'm not sure.
But what you can do, pick up the book that Busy suggested, and you might want to read that before you have your meeting. What was it? 11 simple.
The Art of People, 11 something something. It's just called The Art of People, is the easy way to remember.
There you go.
There we go. I know gamer tag, which is Kevin, said, not Kevin Stevenson, but another
Gotcha.
Kevin. He said, I need a fire 808 beat from BusyWorks Beats for my intro because no gamer tag made the intro, the boom, bam, down, down, you know, with the guitar.
Oh,
He made
dope.
that, the visual part of that. I'm still using it till today, as a matter of fact. Oh wait, did we go that far back in time? Let me see. Yeah, wow, I went all the way back. So now I'm back on the modern stream. So here are more questions. Any ideas on better time management? I need to set up my production and not lose quality. Now you mentioned templates earlier. Oh wait,
Oh, yeah.
and I just got Jay's producer panel day three. So we're almost on the 4 day seminar footage. We got day three. One, three out of four. Okay.
Nice. Yeah, on time management. Wow, definitely. Okay. Templates, like we talked about before, but templates are a smaller part of perfecting your systems. Everything you do is a system. When from you opening your DAW to loading a track to the way you make a beat, it's all systems and monotonous steps that you repeat over and over again. Find where you're wasting time. For instance, I was doing something the other day, and I'm gonna tell you how I trim my time down. I was taking about 30 minutes to do this one task, and I was doing it over and over that day. But then I started timing myself. And I realized it really only takes me 12 minutes to do it. But without having a time limit to do that specific task, I can get distracted or just kind of bop through it. So one of the best ways to manage your time is literally with a time manager, like I always butcher this, Pomodoro timer.
Oh yeah.
Anyway, what that is a timer with cycles. So for instance, you work for 30 minutes, and then the timer goes off, you break for 15 minutes. Then that timer goes off and you back to work for 30 minutes. You back to this. There are a lot of them, like on the App Store or on Google Play. The one I like to use the most is called Seconds Pro. I
Seconds?
use that for everything.
Seconds like milliseconds?
Yep, like seconds on a watch.
Yeah, on a
Yep.
watch.
So I'll
Okay.
take it a step further. So for a specific task, I have specific timers set up. So if I'm doing sound design or I'm making whatever, I know this part takes 8 minutes. I give myself a 30 to 60 second buffer to wrap it up. Then the next part starts. That takes 13 minutes. The next part I know takes 3 minutes. So that way I'm able to manage and predict how many of these I can get done in any given period of time because I know how long each part is. So when it comes to things like time management and productivity, I get really like into the details. And that's how you can turn something like art into a predictable outcome. Mm-hmm. You can measure.
Now that takes also knowing the process, like the fact that something takes 3 minutes, you know how to do it in 3 minutes. Cause yeah. Sometimes I'll make like minute little videos and I'm like, I ate up the whole minute talking about nonsense. You don't realize until you start measuring. You really don't realize like how fast a minute can go by. So we're back in time a little bit with the chat on my screen, my phone screen. It says, Nevia says, Brody, I'm from Canada. How am I going to come? You fly in, Brody. That's what you do.
Just like me. He was from Canada.
No
he
excuses. Yeah.
Anaheim joint.
Puneet flew in from Canada, from Ontario, I think. Was it Ontario? Somewhere like that. To Anaheim, California to make it. In like 2 days notice, he flew in. So you have no excuses, Nevius. Fly in, get a hotel. Come to New York March 31st to the Music Producer Mastermind meeting. If you're really serious about your life and you want to explode into growth, then prove it. Prove it to me that you're serious. Where are we at here? How to start a business with little to no money. Well, that's the title of the stream. Sorry about that, Hazy. But that's a broad question. That's why we're having this stream. Also answering your questions live too. SLE Shadow SLE says, what all do you need to start making beats? So I guess you have a ton of equipment suggestions in your resources section. I saw how you kind of took away some tabs and consolidated and made a whole layout. I like that. On the resources tab. So I would say go to soundoracle.net and go to his resources tab.
Yeah, I would too. Start in the laptop section and the stand section and start from there.
The stand
section. You want to build from the inside out when it comes to production. What are the core things that you need? Well, today you can buy as many controllers as you want, but none of them work without a computer. So you get a computer. If you already have a computer, you need software. What's your software? If you already have software, and then you just build out according to what your personal preference and your personal needs are. Not according to what just came out, not according to what your friends have, but evaluate everything, look at the reviews, see what you need based on how you work. And like I said, build from the inside out.
So if Shadow wanted like a customized plan for his needs, can you help him out with that with a consultation?
I could. You can go to soundoracle.net and scroll down. You'll see consultation, one-on-one consultation. Just click on that.
That's what I suggest, Shadow, because it's really dependent also on what you're trying to do with your studio and budget and all these things. Demetrius says, blah, blah, blah. What kind of beats? Oh, he's talking to Melinda. Melinda's getting all the attention. Shout out to Melinda again. You're in Cali, Melinda? Awesome. I'll be out in Cali April 23rd through the 28th. We hope to do something with Curtis King out there. Somebody said Curtis King or Riot. Curtis King from San Bernardino, Cali. I guess so. All of the conversation can be simplified to a sentence. I'm not sure what he's talking about. Here's one question, 808 Beats. I hear always from rappers and people that music industry people are shady. Is that true? If yes, why?
It's not everybody, but yeah, the business itself is pretty cutthroat. It's pretty shady. The only thing I could think of worse off the top would probably be Hollywood. I think music is like a baby Hollywood in terms of shadiness. But anytime where there's a lot of money involved, and I won't say the barrier to entry to get into the music industry is low, but if you have the right connections, you can get in. So you're dealing with all types of people, you're dealing with all types of money. And I think one of the main things is you're dealing with art. Art is so objective, and the value of it is so objective. It's really, the system itself is a breeding ground for shady activity if you're that type of person. And you can function and thrive in that industry. So the people that are shady, it's not like once they're found out to be shady, they get kicked out of the music industry. No, you stay. And you may even flourish off of your shady dealings. So there's no shunning for shady behavior in the music industry. So that's why it, in my opinion, is still there today.
That's very true. You can kind of camouflage your shadiness, especially when it comes to contracts. It's, people don't read the contracts. That's just what it comes down to. They don't read it and they don't understand what the heck's going on, and they get taken advantage of. But again, there's so many angles to this, like building a team and all this type of stuff, dream team. But that'll take way too much time. So come talk to us in Manhattan, New York, March 31st at the Music Producer Mastermind meeting. Come talk to us in person. K Suave says, or Suave, sorry if I'm saying this wrong, says, is mixing more about getting the sound you want or doing things the right way? So I guess, like, before you answer, I'm sorry. Somebody mentioned Ronnie J, and I remember somebody asking Ronnie J, how does he mix or something? He was just like, I mix the way I feel. Like, there's no rules to mixing. So what do you think?
I think there are no rules to mixing when you have the luxury of saying that. And what I mean by that is you've learned all the rules. So you know which ones to break. You know which ones to build a bend or which ones to omit. Mm-hmm. But you can only say that from knowing what you're doing. You know what I mean? Only when you become at a certain level of anything can you now improvise. And then you build it to be what you want it to be. So his question was, is it about mixing the way you feel or doing things the right way? I think initially it's about doing things the right way to achieve the sound that you feel. Then once you know those things, you can manipulate the system and adapt it to be even more personal. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like some records get known for that heavy distorted sound, like XXXTentacion and what's the other guy's name? Smoke Perp and I'm going blank on the other name. Ronnie J's records. They're known for like distorting the track overly. Lil Pump, that's his name. But if you listen, the initial version that's on SoundCloud or whatever is super distorted, but then the radio version is not super distorted. They still have distortion, but it's not clipping and doing all that stuff because they made it so you can hear the vocals and all the other stuff that's important to an actual mix. So, I mean, even these rough drafts that they put on SoundCloud get cleaned up for the record. I mean, for the mainstream. So just be aware of that, especially for the music video. Compare the music video to Lil Pump's like SoundCloud track where it's super distorted. And I'm sure that's a record label decision, of course. Or I mean, he doesn't deal with record labels, I don't think. How about, oh, he's asking for a producer name. Everybody's giving him suggestions on his producer name. The way I got my producer name, just a quick story, is that there used to be this anime show called Yu-Gi-Oh, which was about like a card game or something. And I used to watch it. One of the characters' name was Yu-Gi, and he was the king of games. So I was like, all right, I like this game. He's the king of games. Let me be Game King. So I flipped it, and I was Game King C for my initial. And I used that on Xbox and like Xbox Live. And people just called me Game for short. Technically, it's Game King, but they just said Game for short. So I just went with Game. That's how I'm Game today. Through Xbox and through like a Yu-Gi-Oh show.
So, isn't it crazy?
This is random. Like, you just, and BusyWorks Beats, I just stuck with it. There was no thought process. Like, I think I took. What's up?
No rhyme or reason to it. Just
no rhyme or reason. There's a BusyWorks store, I know, for Pharrell or whatever. BusyWork, whatever it's called. Set Sail says, I used to get, oh, he's talking to somebody. I usually get stuck on two, but how do you feel about combining? I don't know what he's talking about. Chauncey says, any ideas on better time management? I think you went over that. Mm-hmm. Hold on. Hazy says, can a producer make good income just off streaming alone?
You're doing a lot of damn streams.
Yeah. A lot of streams, yeah. Here's a quick tip. Because YouTube, people think YouTube is like a job. Don't chase like making YouTube a career. Because you're going to have to get tons and tons of views. And when you don't get those views, you're going to be depressed. And it's going to be just a ridiculous race. Because they're always going to change the algorithm. So don't make it your career. I think YouTube pays I forget the rates. Let me look it up. Streaming rates. All you have to do is look up streaming rates on Google. You'll pull up some kind of table of the percentages from YouTube versus Spotify versus whatever. Here's the table. So YouTube pays point. There's so many zeros here. So it pays. It pays $0.00074 per stream. So in short, you know, from experience, it takes about 1,000 streams to get a dollar on YouTube. And let me see here. Streams per song, amount of streams. Stream quality, quantity. I don't know what these other stats are, but compare whatever the value is on YouTube on these tables to about, that's about $1 per every 1,000 streams. So anything higher than 0.0074 is a pretty good number. You have Spotify at 0.00397. So that's really good compared to the 0.000 on YouTube. So you're going to, so for about 1,000 streams, I guess you get paid $10 instead of $1 on Spotify, just comparing that one decimal point. So just kind of compare that theory going through. I think it's worth it, but again, you still have to get a lot of views and streams, and that's hard to do when people don't have these services in the first place.
Yeah, and you have to be really consistent, not only with your content, but consistent with that amount of viewers. Mm-hmm. Over time, or you have to grow that number, or else you're just gonna get less.
Yeah, I just use a streaming site just like a YouTube page. You put up hundreds of videos on YouTube, why not use your streaming site to put up hundreds of songs and just grow your brand that way, instead of trying to put a hit record out one at a time? You know, you just never know. Got to put in the work. Like Ray Shrimmer, those two guys.
Yeah,
I heard from Mike Will, like, they're the hardest working duo ever. They just work and work and work and work and work. They never stop. So you got to do that regardless of wherever you are in the business. Again, going through questions. Somebody said, is that task jacking off? I guess when you were referring to your system of
wasting time.
Wasting time. Let's see here. Let me find a good question. I'm sorry. Revenant says, hey, game. So I put all my time into making music and trying to better myself, spewing out beats, but I've been told that could crash creativity, and I wanted to know your opinion on how often to practice. So I'll leave that up to you, Oracle. What do you think about repetition and being busy? Because then you mentioned something about being busy versus being productive.
Yeah. You don't want to be busy. And the simple way, no pun intended, but the simple way to go about it is just knowing why you're doing certain things. If it doesn't achieve the bottom line or whatever your main goal is, then, or it's not a necessary function of life, then it's a waste of time. That's just simply how I look at it.
Sorry, this is going back in time. The ATL meeting with the Grammy lady, he said, the meeting is in the last week of April. I'll be there for 2 weeks. I would love to link you, Oracle. Oh, sorry. He said, I would love to link with you, Oracle, and learn as much as possible. He said the last week of April.
I can't call it, but fill out a contact form on my site, just so like I have you on my radar.
True. And follow up. And like, here's something you could do. I'm just throwing this out there just to show people how to understand value. Introduce Oracle to this Grammy lady. That's how you add value, and that's how you become more valuable to the lady as well, because he probably has a lot more leverage than you in this case, and a lot more resources, a lot more friends he can call upon for whatever she's trying to do. I don't know what she's trying to do, though. So I'm just saying, that's how you think about meetings and introductions and stuff. Questions. I don't want to use ascending keys, blah blah blah. 808 Beat says, someone here making old... Oh, sorry. Thought that was a question. What's up?
You pointed out a really good point with that last thing. Mm-hmm. Sometimes your greatest value, if you don't have much to leverage, is being the plug. It's so much value in connecting two people together. That's... You're valuable in that aspect, if you could plug two people together. Mm-hmm.
Sunny Digital even was like... Like, I introduced him to him to make this record. Like, but he was mad because he didn't get the credit or something for it. I think Sunny Digital does that. He introduces people to create these hit records and stuff. Supposedly. I don't know the truth behind it, but that's what he said. What? Okay. A lot of comments, but no questions. If you release a royalty-free loop pack, this is from Snow Barnes. If you release a royalty-free loop pack, and one of your loops becomes a hit song, do you get a cut?
No, it's royalty free.
It is royalty free.
Remix.
Yeah. You made that decision going in that it's royalty free. Therefore, you agreed to not negotiate any back end percentages. But I think maybe his question deep down was, so producers who sell beats online for a flat fee or whatever, there's some instances people listed before that they get cut in on a percentage of the record eventually, like Menace or I forget the Coco beat, whoever made the Coco beat. I'm in love with the Coco. I guess that was an online producer or something.
Yeah.
And maybe they got cut into the back end. I think that's off the grace of the artist and the label. I don't think that's like a mandatory thing that they had to do that. I think that's just off a relationship thing.
Yeah, like I was saying earlier, unless it's stated somewhere up front, then nah.
Then nah.
That's why I like it. Establish that stuff up front. When you run a business where like anybody could buy your beat, anybody could rap on it, you should have those types of things built in already, because trying to chase those types of things afterwards is virtually impossible unless, like you said, the grace of the artist and they just reach back and then pull you in, because they don't really owe you anything because you never told them they did from the jump.
Didn't somebody give you like credit on a record just because like
you that has happened mentored? A few times with me. Yeah. And I get publishing on a few records from people that use my royalty-free sounds just because they reach back.
There you go. Abuse those SoundOracle.net sounds and please send them that check. Send them the whatever it's called, the paperwork I meant to say afterwards. Ziggy on the beat says, best tip I've got so far about the business end of the industry was when Oracle and Trizza suggested moving and branching out away from my city because of its location. So I'm not sure where Ziggy was before.
I forget where he was, but yo, shout out to Ziggy, man. Always showing love.
Oh, you know Ziggy?
Yeah.
See? That's what I'm saying. You got to be known. People who are repetitively showing up, like Noah, Dot Chaos, I know these guys because their avatar is the same. They show up consistently. That's what your branding is. You're consistent about showing up. And now we know you via your username, but the best part is meeting us in person. So that's going to solidify all those years of being a username in the chat room. So come out to Music Producer Mastermind Meeting. Yes, I'm leading to that. Come out to Music Producer Mastermind Meeting 31st of March, which is March 31st this month in New York. It's going to be in Manhattan, New York, high-end luxury. It's going to be at 48 Lounge, and I'm going to send out the information. Tickets are going to start at $150. Again, we're separating people who are serious from people who are not serious. That's just the plain and simple way to say it. And if you show up March 31st, we will be there. Sound Oracle will be there.
Yeah.
Trizza will be there. God willing. And, you know, maybe we'll invite some friends. You never know. But it's all about getting you to the next level, surrounding yourself with people who are about the same thing. That's the secret. Okay. I even sometimes after your Unquantized show, we link up and we surround ourselves by each other and we link up and chat and do share some things.
Yeah. Those are some great discussions, man. Yeah. But that's a mastermind me within itself, sharing tools and tactics and strategies. That's amazing.
It really is amazing. It's going to transform your business. This is the secret stuff that nobody really tells you. It's the stuff that you know about, but you think it doesn't really matter. But it does matter. Game King, by the way. Somebody said, Ascending Key said, Game, is it cool to sell a beat you know isn't finished, but people still want it? Of course. You went on this before. It's like the market is going to tell you what they want.
Yep.
Right?
That's true.
These questions are very sporadic. A lot of chatting going on. Should producers register their beats with websites such as TuneCore to get their beats onto streaming platforms such as Tidal and Spotify? So I think his question from Yandora is, should the beat be the product or should they sell the beat so somebody else can stream it as a song, I mean?
What are the benefits, financially and otherwise? Mm-hmm. That's what you got to figure out. Because I don't know about TuneCore and all of that stuff.
Right.
But I know that you're illustrating that there are two ways to go about it. Once again, pros and cons, which way looks better. Mm-hmm. And is it one of those instances where you can take advantage of exploring both options at the same time? Split testing, if you will.
Split testing. Goodness, he let out a cat out the bag.
Yeah, I'm gonna be easy with the
split testing, huh? Split pea soup? What? You got to change it into something else.
Right.
I was gonna say, I'd say my suggestion is monetize your stuff before it even gets sold. So like, put it on YouTube, put it on Spotify, put it on Tidal, just as a beat, so you get monetized plays. So when people are previewing it to buy it, you get monetized plays, And on top of that, they can buy it. And then if, you know, long story short, you can take it down and give them the copyrights or whatever you do if you're selling the exclusive. But if you're not selling the exclusive, remember that you own the copyright to your work. So it looks like you need to understand a little bit of the copyright law to really understand what that is, because the instrumental version is going to be different than the song version. So, you know, I'd say dig into copyright law a little bit. Go to copyright.gov, learn some more. Make humanity great. Sorry, it's not a question. Oh, wait, he says, my producer name might be Kizzy Hertz Beats. Oh, he's joking. Wow, I thought that was real. Sometimes I read comments like it's serious.
Yeah.
I felt real salty.
I was about to hit you with a special sound effect.
What else do you have on there? Is horns?
I got the horns, but I think he's about to get this one. Bruh.
The bruh. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, one of these.
What's that, the tape?
Good old record, needle across the record joint.
Stop, that's hilarious. I haven't heard that one in a long time, if any time.
Facts. Funny, that was from a movie. I sampled that from a movie, a Cheech and Chong movie. Yeah. It's like a whole like speech that goes with that.
Those are so funny, like those tape stops. In comedy skits and stuff where he goes, yeah, you know, yeah, I mean, right. I can't do it, but you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Like the shorter version.
No quicker way to illustrate that somebody's not wanted in a certain place.
Hilarious, man. Hold on one sec. I'm trying to multitask on my brain. Noah West says, what's your opinion on 10,000 hours of training?
I'm all about it. I am all about, mastery at whatever you choose in the master. And of course, 10,000 hours is the rule that everybody likes to say. On top of 10,000 hours, though, I also like to say, putting in 10,000 hours, you become great at it, but you're not a true master until you can teach somebody else.
See, I like how you just end on like a gym and you just cut it.
Just drop off.
You just drop off. No fade, no outro. Just cut the record right there. Yeah. Awesome. I like that. That's better than anything I could ever answer with that one. Ziggy says, what advice do you have for someone who works a full-time job and tries to work on production as well?
You still got hours. Mm-hmm. You might not have 24 hours to do what you do, but you have some hours. And inside of those hours, you have pockets to where you are probably wasting time and you could be focused on more. You got to get it in when you can and where you can. You still got to get your 10,000 hours in. Even if you got to do it 30 minutes at a time, you still got to do it.
You got to rewind the stream. And Oracle went over his time management. He measures the process to know how long a certain portion of the process takes. So on top of that, he's the Pomodoro method. So go back, rewind the stream, and you'll get that information alongside of what he just said. Sam P says, what's the best way to get money? Be famous and work with well-credited artists in the music industry as a producer. I want to achieve all these, but I don't know how I should attack these goals. So before you give your spiel, I guess, I'll say what you're trying to do is like hop into a job that's cut out for you. So it's like, I just want to do one thing and that one thing only. In order to do that, you have to have people around you. Okay, so the system you're chasing right now is a system. So it works with most likely a label of some sort who owns a studio or has ties with the studio, who knows the engineers and blah, blah, blah. They have a process for creating a product. You just want to be the one piece of that whole machine. Whereas if you want to run your own business, you can't just be one cog in the wheel, one cog in the machine. You have to be everything, or at least assemble people around you who can be the other pieces. So you have to determine, you know, are you seeking a job or are you seeking entrepreneurship or are you seeking validation through some systematized industry like iTunes or how Hollywood works? Like, what are you chasing? I think is the better question.
Yeah, I don't think there's a clearly defined goal there. I mean, he did list a lot of things that he wants to accomplish, but those aren't really goals. Those are byproducts of real goals. Like, fame is a byproduct. Money is a byproduct or a tool of doing the right thing. The worst thing you can say is you want to be famous. Or that's the one of the worst things you can try to chase, because it's fleeting and it's not what it's cracked up to be. And if you ever do achieve it, you may find yourself in a worse situation than you were before because you weren't tied into a real goal. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. Watch out for the difference between chasing real meaningful goals and chasing byproducts of goals.
And then the cliffhanger, he just leaves you with a cliffhanger. Cliffhanger shawty or young cliffhanger.
Cliff Huxtable over here.
Cliff Huxtable. Oh my gosh. Huxtable. Oh my gosh. That's hilarious. I went on my rant about that. But I think a lot of producers are trying to say, I just want to do one thing, but they don't realize in order to do one thing, you still have to do everything until you can do one thing. Like, yeah, you have to do a lot in order to just say, I want to do this all the time. Yeah. Like, imagine every day we just wanted to eat all day long. You have to do other stuff except eat. Right. Dot KS says, what's up?
Okay, go. I was going to go into another thing about that. We can move it on.
Oh, go ahead. Go for it.
Okay. What was I going to say? So yeah, doing that one thing. Okay, if you got everything that you wanted, you got to work with big name artists, you get the money and you work with, that takes a lot of maintenance. For instance, working with these artists, are you booking your own flights? You're making a lot of money. Are you doing your own accounting? Are you doing your own taxes? Like, it still requires people, and the loftier that these goals are, if you just make them vague in general, you don't take into account the things that it really takes to support that goal. Your goal is not going to hang in midair. It has to be supported by something. And most of the time, it's going to be people. So you still have to go through all those things that are the tedious things to get to where you have to go. And to stay where you want to be, you got to have a good foundation. So,
yeah. Dang, another cliffhanger. Cliff Huxtable.
Say that for now. You know what it is? I went to pilot school. They didn't teach me how to land the plane. I just cut the engine off.
Just with canted wheels and everything. Sideways wheels. You know? So I think, Sam P, I meant to say that you got to realize that a lot of these studios and stuff, they have a system already built. So you're trying to like inject yourself into somebody else's system of creating a product and just trying to like squeeze your way in. You know, again, I'm just using the record label example. Record labels give a command for a song to re-record it or something like that. So they have their go-to studios. They have their artist who's going to be in the studio. They have their go-to engineers because they trust these people. They have, who else is involved? Maybe a songwriting camp if they're really about like building this artist out. They have, what else can people do from a label's perspective? So they have all that stuff because they're trying to create a product. They already have their go-to guys. So I think my whole concern for you is that you understand that that's a system and it's not going to be entrepreneurship per se once you get into that system. So you're going to be an intrapreneur, not necessarily an entrepreneur. Just be careful, you know. Okay, that's a long rant. But anyway, Dot KS says, are y'all familiar with Battle the Beatmakers in Toronto, Canada? Game knows what I'm talking about. Yeah. Have you seen it on YouTube where like Metro was the judge one time?
Yeah, and Boy Wonder was there.
Boy Wonder? Yeah. Those are hilarious, man. Like, my whole joke about those is like producers never know what to do on stage.
No.
Like, they'll start, they'll just get into it, like head bobbing and doing all this. I mean, they never know what to do. It's the funniest thing ever. Like, and one guy was getting clowned on because he was like off beat to his own beat. So he was doing all this chanting stuff, but it was like way off beat. I was like, oh man, I'm not sure how that looks.
I saw a dude checking his phone one time. I was like, oh, that's new. The Beast Way, he's just like, he's out there like texting. I'm cool. I'm like, wow, never thought of that before.
Oh man, live stream. It'd be cooler to live stream. Like, if you feel uncomfortable in that situation, just live stream on your phone and like turn to the crowd or something. That way, that's a smart way of like, if you don't like being on the crowd and on the stage, even at iStandard, now I'm thinking about it, in Philly, people just didn't know what to do on a stage because it is kind of like a weird, like you're not performing anything. just the beat.
You know so what do I you bob your head? To?
What's etiquette? What's proper etiquette?
Etiquette is usually the head bob.
Yeah.
But you know what I compare it to? And this is something I hate when people sing happy birthday to you. Especially if a group of people are singing this slow. Because what do? You just standing there like, hey, yeah, we only on the fourth word. This is a long song. Thank you.
Right.
So, yeah, it's kind of like that.
That's hilarious, man. Somebody said you can do online beat battle. What happened to like Rock Battle? Have you heard of that website?
Yeah. I don't know. If so, then not as popular as they once were, because I don't hear about it a lot.
Hold on. Oh, Rock. Oh, wait. I see Facebook.com. I don't see a website.
Ooh.
Oh, I see Twitter. I see SoundCloud. I think they turned it into Crunchbase. Crunchbase. I don't. Or no, that's a directory. Never mind. Wait, does rockbattle.com exist? Hold on. Let me check. Oh, it does. Okay, it does exist. But that was like one of the pioneer sites for producer beat battles and stuff that I can recall. Just the idea of making something under pressure might get me to train how to become more creative. I think he was talking about your system.
It definitely will. It definitely will. You'll become way more aware, like immediately.
Yeah. Here's a question from Lone.
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. Here's a question from Lona Square. Isn't it very alarming that many producers still don't understand that full... Sorry, people got to word these questions better. I'm sorry, Loner. Isn't it very alarming that many producers still don't understand the full importance of maintaining publishing when sampling? 100% for a sample is too much to sacrifice, isn't it?
Yeah, 100%. I've never been in that situation.
100%, sorry. It's just funny to think about 100%. Go ahead.
I've never been in that situation. The worst situation I've seen is where someone asks for a bigger percentage than the producer owns. You could also get into that problem if you get sued.
Mm-hmm.
And like if you don't clear and then you get sued, often you'll get sued for a bigger percentage of the song than you own, and then that's when you have to contact the other people involved in the song and ask for money. And you don't want to be.
I don't know why that's funny. Like you have 6%, but they sue for like 15. You got to borrow 9%.
Yes, I've seen that happen. Like, you should just clean it off the rip.
That's terrible. Here's a different way of thinking about giving away 100%. Here's a marketing strategy too. Like if you want to build out affiliates. Like, have you heard of affiliate marketing? Well, duh. I don't know why I'm asking you. But I'm sorry.
I was like, oh, no, that question was for me, but yeah.
Yeah, my bad. For affiliate marketing, like on Amazon, they'll offer you 8%, but that's a very low percentage. So a technique I learned from a marketer was that why not offer 100%? I'm just saying this is a strategy, not saying everybody should do it. Why not offer 100% affiliate fee? Because that person's bringing you a new customer anyway. So look at it as like a breaking even point to increasing your mailing list or your audience. And you can sell to them different things over time. So somebody mentioned, I think it was Diego Av said he'd get on a Drake mixtape for like no back end or something. I forget what he said, but like no points or anything. But he'd do it because his name is going to be broadcasted by Drake. So that's the same kind of concept. Just in the music field. Ramsey the Great, blah, blah, blah. Anyone? Okay. They said, anyone else heard of Ninth Wonder? Who hasn't here? I guess you can't really say that nowadays. Where has Ninth Wonder gone?
Teaching. Is he still teaching?
Is it North Carolina?
He was doing, he was a professor somewhere.
Yeah, at
North Carolina?
North Carolina? The one with, I forget this, Duke.
Oh, he's at Duke. Okay, yeah.
I think it's Duke. Okay.
Well, I know he's somewhere teaching. That's all I know. And when I was at, remember I was at the Blacks and Wax Museum in D.C. and I did that live stream.
Blacks on Wax? Okay.
The Blacks and Wax Museum in D.C. That's African American Museum. Blacks and Wax is in Baltimore. My bad. But anyway, they had this music section that was talking about hip hop music. And the narrator or the main person in the video is Ninth Wonder.
What?
Yeah, like going over like hip hop production at the African American Museum, like on a big screen on repeat. in this one section of a museum. So
just levels. I mean, that's the offline world, a whole new world to explore. I mean, infinite opportunity out there, but people just, they think it's just artist to artist all the time. Hazy says, would you ever bring Mastermind to London? London, UK?
I'm not scared of the rain.
Of the rain? I thought you were going to say the flight across the ocean, but you said the rain.
Nah.
Okay.
That flight isn't too bad. Mm-hmm. I went to Berlin, and it wasn't too bad.
How many hours was that?
I want to say it was nine.
Nine. Wow, an extra three? The only... Yeah. Coming back from California was like, I don't know what it was, but the coming back part took forever. I think because like I was a little different as far as my physiology at that point. But going there was like a breeze. But coming back, I was kind of uncomfortable. So maybe it extended the 6-hour flight.
Yeah, it wasn't bad. I have the uncanny ability to sleep through at least 80% of any flight. Most of the time, 100%. So I think on that 9-hour flight, I actually slept the whole time coming back or something. Mm-hmm. And I slept 80% of the time going the other way. So
80%. Like, it really helps to bring somebody on flights. Like if you're flying into the Music Producer Mastermind meeting in New York for March 31st, again at 48 Lounge, which is in Manhattan, New York, again, March 31st, 2018. If you're flying in, or when you fly in, I should say, bring somebody with you. Cause that helps the plane ride. If you're going to stay up, if you're going to sleep, I guess it doesn't matter. But I did sleep, actually, when I was with Jay flying. I did sleep at a certain point. Then I woke up. So
I'm making my business to be asleep before we take off.
Are you flying with Triz or are you going separate?
I don't know. We'll work that out. It'd be cool if we could fly together, but, you know, we'll see what the schedules look like.
Oh, his miles aren't... He doesn't have gold status like you for first class or anything.
Hey, listen, man. I didn't know what my status was. I hadn't checked on it in a minute, but that trip to Cali let me look up my status. I had a lot more miles than I thought I did.
I got the wrong credit card. I don't have the one that rewards you flight points because I didn't think I'd ever be flying ever.
Yeah.
But now I'm like, oh, I'm flying a lot. That was like a cross-country trip. That would have been like a free trip. So I need to get up on that. I have the wrong credit card.
I eat at the places that give me rewards. I shop at the places that give me rewards. Like, yeah, I'm all about it.
You got it mapped out?
Yeah.
Okay, one sec. He says, I'm from where? Okay. How often do you stream game? Mondays and Thursdays for this Music Producer Conversations. But I stream randomly. I mean, we'll have more of a structured stream at BusyWorksBeats.com, the new BusyWorksBeats.com. Private streams, not on YouTube. It's going to be more structured. Okay. Fusty says, I'm going to come to that event and flex my scuffed J's. There you go.
There you go.
I thought he was going to say something important, but he's trolling. Dot Chaos says, so I assume you know about Little Brother?
Yeah, of course.
Isn't that that's an artist or is that an album?
As a group. Ninth One, wow. The producer.
Okay, yeah. I'm mixing it all up. I'm not familiar with everybody, like I said, and I'm not going to act like I know everybody. Somebody said, I like the social proof. Oh, sorry. Make Humanity Great Again says, I like the social proof mechanisms on Sound Oracle's site.
Thank you.
I don't know what he's referring to. Oh, that picture with, I know what it is. I think it's the thing where you put everybody's picture on it.
Oh, yeah. All the people that use sounds from soundoracle.net.
The big acts I'm talking about,
it's like Justin and Drake and Tim and Beyonce and a few other people on there.
Yeah, I caught that too the other day.
Gary Vaynerchuk on there. I took him off and replaced him with Chris Brown, but I think I might put Gary V back.
Gary V might be more, known in our culture. I mean, more like, what's the word I'm looking for? Renowned in our culture than I'm joking, Chris Brown. But.
You know, I like having him up there, the Gary V, because it's such a throw off.
Yeah. This is random.
Gary V put out an album?
An album, yeah. You might have given the sounds or whatever to the producer who learned from us, who said he got his intro song on Gary V. Was that the kid?
Awareness. Awareness 303 is his name. He is part of the Unquantized producer community. He had been inspired by the podcast. He really started putting his best foot forward, and he got in with Gary Vee and D-Rock, and he's done multiple, music things for them, and continues to do it to this day. And he always uses SoundOracle.net sounds on all his Gary Vee stuff. So, you know, he has his social proof. I get my social proof through him, and it's it comes back around because it's from the podcast. He got the gems from the podcast that got him to where he is, and he gives back.
Awesome. And I'm not sure if we're talking about the same guy, but somebody messaged me on Facebook like, yo, man, thank you. Again, they reach back to you and tell you, thank goodness, because we wouldn't know unless they tell us. But he reached back and he was like, yeah, man, I got my song on the intro of Gary Vee. Thank you. You taught me everything. So I was like, is that the same guy? I wasn't sure. But I have to look up. I don't know his stage name. I just know his real name.
It might be.
It might be the same dude.
If not, the two people out there that we got in the Gary Vee camp.
That's interesting, man. Melinda said, I saw Melinda's comment earlier. Again, we're way back in time. Hit me up when you out here, game. Get out here. Get out here. I'm coming. I'm going. I can't read. Sorry. Here's what she said. At BusyWorks Beats, hit me up when you get out here. Oh, I'm going. Sorry. My brain's a little slow today. I didn't eat too much. yeah, I'll be out in... La Jolla, California, April 23rd through the 28th. So we'll do something with Curtis King out that way. Reading these comments. Jack Tripper says, don't have money for plane ticket, but dang, I wish I could be there. Well, darn, you got to get your money up, man, so you can afford the stuff. That's what you can save money for. If you want to save money for anything that's going to be worth it, instead of buying like an arbitrary synth that you're probably not going to use, like over here I have a Virus TI that I probably use four times in life. And it's the $2,000 synth. Like, I don't know why I have it. I don't use it because it doesn't sync up with the computer the way I thought. That's the main reason.
I got you.
Like, the plugin is weird. It's like a time delay thing. But I have stuff in the studio that I have not accessed the full value of. And I should have invested that into moments like these. Music producer mastermind meetings.
You're making me feel bad now. I'm looking around. I'm like, oh, man.
I want you to take a look to your left and your right. And I want you to look around and see where you haven't extracted value. Yeah, I have keyboards in the other room that are like $3,000 keyboards that I barely touch. Mainly because these rooms are separated. But it's just stupid stuff like that.
I'm looking at the native control keyboard, the 61 key. I think I used it two times. And now it's sitting on a table looking like decoration. I got the Machine Mach 3 right here. And the Machine Studio right here. One of these could have been something. I could have spent the money on something else.
Just layering up machines. Yeah. Machine Studios. Well, let me find a different question. I'm running out of vocal juice. Can we do six more minutes?
Sure, let's go.
Or did you want to ride out for an hour? I don't know if I could hang for an hour.
I'm just being honest with you.
I don't think I can make it.
I definitely got a few things I got to get back to. So, yeah, we can ride off for six more minutes.
Okay. Let me slide down. How do you stop people from stealing beats online? I'd say anything online is, you could take it. Yeah. So, just attract people who are willing to pay for it. What's up?
It comes with the territory.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, nothing you can do about that.
Then he said, do you have to pay for copyright?
People ask about copyright a lot. Didn't you go over that a lot, don't you?
Yeah, it's very long, but in short, when you put something in a public medium like YouTube or SoundCloud, it's automatically copyrighted. If you have it like, because we were talking about clearing the sample before. So if you put up a sample beat directly to YouTube, you're responsible for that being public as a sample record. But if you did a sample record for an artist who didn't release it to the public and you're doing a sample beat that way, it's not technically a public thing yet until that artist releases it after clearing the sample. So that was our kind of context before. In short, just go to copyright.gov and learn for yourself. That's the only way you're going to understand it. Can you monetize on any music platform on TuneCore? I only see YouTube monetization. Pretty sure TuneCore has other things like Spotify and all the main distribution channels. So you need to really investigate that a little bit more. I think you're asking about like SoundCloud monetization, maybe. But that's the difference between these outlets. They all have different features. Somebody said game my buyer packs too. Thank you. Yeah,
Yes,
that's what
sir.
I'm worried about. I want to. He says he's worried about people stealing his tracks, but he wants people to hear it, but he doesn't want to put tags all over it. What do you have to say about beat tags?
Beat tags are necessary, but he's right. Once you start putting tags all throughout the track, it's terrible. Your tag should be in there one time, maybe two times if you're super paranoid. But what I will say, I'm not going to give away my methodology to how I did things, but you can get creative. People use beat tags and all that, but that's what everybody does. Try to think outside the box and maybe be a little more creative.
Well, that sounded real esoteric and secret. So you got to ask him at the music producer mastermind meeting for the rest of
Yeah.
those keys.
I have a method that I used to use, and I will tell somebody if they meet me in person
Only if you
at the mastermind meeting in New York.
March 31st, 48 Lounge, Manhattan, New York, upscale, luxury, high end. Okay, tickets start at 150. Yes, 150 bucks. If you can't scrape up 150 bucks to change your life, then I don't think 10 bucks is going to change your life from the beat you're trying to sell tomorrow. So, you need to make better decisions in life. So come join us March 31st, the Music Producer Mastermind meeting at 48 Lounge, Manhattan, New York. Yes, March 31st, the end of the month. You can meet Oracle himself, Sound Oracle himself, and Trizza. It's going to be popping up if you want the rest of that answer. I said 6 minutes, but I ended up talking like way longer. 808 Beats is da, da, da. How much should you do or have done to sell your first beat? I have no idea what that means.
Yeah, well, how much did you do or how much did you have done?
Oh, maybe credits, maybe? Maybe that's it.
I thought he was talking about like website or the platform or having that stuff set up. I don't know. That's a really, you got to drill that question down a little bit more.
Right, that's very kind of broad, not specific enough. I'm looking for question marks. Everybody else is getting skipped. Again, we appreciate everybody for joining us in the live stream. We went on for a good 3 hours and about 15 minutes of just
Did
pure diamonds dropped by Sound Oracle.
and busy works.
I'm just ad-libbing, as Trizza would say. I'm ad-libbing here.
Yeah,
Noah says, wait, hold on. I didn't read the whole question, but he says, "What's a question you would ask if you guys were in the position of one of us in the chat?" So I guess he's saying, since the chat questions aren't good enough, what would you ask someone like us if you had the opportunity?
The most important question, well, it's not really for this particular format, but for somebody like us, if I met me or you and I was you get what I'm saying. What do you need? Do you need anything? Is there anything I can help you with? That will get you in more doors than almost anything you could possibly say.
Wow. Yeah, I was not even thinking on that level. I was thinking complete selfishness. Like, how do I get my answer now? So I wasn't even on that wavelength. So that caught me off guard. I would say, what would I ask myself or Oracle? Dag, that is a deep question. I would ask, what's the greatest growth strategy you've learned in the last year? Like, what's the greatest tactic you've done growth-wise in the last year? And I'd say personally, going to meet people in person, like the mastermind meeting. Again, I'm not like self-inflating myself. You can ask anybody who went to the Anaheim one. They're still talking about it. Their lives changed like that. You can look at their Instagram and see before and after that meeting, and it changed dramatically. Does Beats Music show his face now? He shows his face now a lot more. He's doing videos. He's singing in his videos. He's doing a bunch of content now. Puneet from FNS Productions. You got Chris Thompson writing articles on LinkedIn. A bunch of people's lives are changed. RJ Knox, who was on the panel, actually kind of gained a new breath of life.
Right.
So
He was in the choir. He got saved.
he got saved.
He was on stage. But that's real. That shows how much just energy and good information was there. He was on the panel giving information, and he received so much good information that he changed his stuff. That's right. saying a lot.
True. And that's the importance of meeting people in person, being around people of the same spirit. I'm going to skip the rest of the questions, unfortunately, because my voice is just gone and I have to do some stuff. So what are some ways to overcome living in a small town well, this is a good question we can end off on. Sorry. Yandora says, what are some ways to overcome living in small towns without much of a music scene?
Okay, quick ways. Mm-hmm. Find what little bit of music scene is there and link with that. Use the internet to your best abilities. It is your best friend, considering your location, and save up so you could take trips to things like the music producer mastermind meeting in another city.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yes. Again, you can work remotely with this internet thing of ours. All right. So I'm going to wrap up this stream. There's a lot of kind of offset questions going down, but I apologize if we didn't get to you. Again, I was not where you are in the chat, so I apologize. But let's end this. Thank you again. This is Sound Oracle, my top left, if you're new. And that's soundoracle.net. Be different, be dope. Do you have that t-shirt for sale?
I actually do. It's on the site. If you click show more, I have so many products. Yeah. You click show more, you will see the shirt.
There it is. And again, I watch this Unquantized podcast every Friday at 4 p.m. Eastern time on his Instagram, which is at Sound Oracle. Let me type it in the chat. And you will see me, you know, if I'm on the road, I can't type all the time, but I'm listening in. I'll check in at least. But I will be there.
I say every time, this is one of your only chances. You'll be in the chat with Game. Mm-hmm. You always see him on the camera, but when he comes on our shows on Fridays, he's in the chat with you. It's an awesome experience, man. And we thank you for tuning in. You tune in like every Friday, man. Awesome. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, now I'm more on it now because I'm used to Instagram. Before, I didn't have the notifications set up, so I never knew. And I would always forget, and it'd be like 5 p.m. I figured out the notifications thing finally because I did the same thing you guys did, was turn off your notifications so it doesn't distract you thing. But then I realized I'm missing out on a lot by not paying attention. So again, final call. We're going to have tickets soon. In New York, we're hosting the next Music Producer Mastermind meeting. This is for the serious people only. This is not for dabblers. If you want to hang and meet some cool people, hey, I'm not stopping you. But, you know, come down. Come on down to 48 Lounge, Midtown Manhattan. Now, this is going to be flex gear.
Huh? Got to wear your flex gear, too.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to put attire, flex gear only. And again, tickets start at $150. Why? Because we want to separate people who are serious from people who aren't. That's going to be at 48 Lounge in New York. So... that's March 31st, 2018. I'm going to be there. Sound Oracle is going to be there. Trizza is going to be there from Unquantized Podcast. You know, we may invite friends. Who knows? But it's about surrounding yourself with people who are serious and trying to get to the next level. That's the whole point. So join us March 31st for everybody watching the replay. The link should be in the video description once it's up. All right. Awesome. Always a pleasure, JNN Music. All right. Take care, Set Sayil. Appreciate you. So let me end the stream. And again, thank you. This is Music Producer Conversations. Somebody put the fax machines. Fax. That's. I'm starting out on your chat for Unquantized. I'm putting fax machines.
I like that.
Every time y'all spit a bar. All right, man.